to the brickyard. But all eyes are on the dome, cause the maggots from Greensboro get ready to lock it up with the big cats from the bill. This weekend is a strong testament on how powerful the black community can be when we stick together. Let's get this game started, y'all.
Indianapolis, Indiana, where festivities for the Circle City Classic began with the parade this morning. That's outdoors. Now we come indoors in the beautiful RCA Dome and get ready to bring you the Circle City Classic between the North Carolina A&T Aggies and the Tennessee State Tigers, both teams 1-3. Hello again, along with the ambassador of Black College Football, Jay Walker, I'm Eric Clemens. Thanks so much for spending part of your football Saturday with us at BET as we celebrate 25 years of bringing you the best in Black College Football. And Jay, with North Carolina A&T, Coach Small took over there a couple of years ago and spoiled the Aggie faithful, getting 10 victories in a MEAC championship, has had trouble living up to those high expectations ever since.
And that's what happens when you come in there as a rookie coach and raise the level of expectation. You go to the NCAA playoffs, your first year as a head coach, your second year you have a subpar season. Now the third year is what they're really going to judge you by, because when you're a first year coach, they think it was the previous coach's talent that brought the championship season. Now if you're Coach Small, you got to determine how much further this program can go and make sure they compete for the MEAC title.
On the other side of the ball, Tennessee State, James Webster in his first year. Team is not as physical as he would like it, but his offense is really struggling a lot more than he would like.
Yeah, it's been a surprising season for Coach Webster. He was pleasantly surprised by the play of his defense. They came in and played better than he thought. They're one of the best defenses in OVC, but he was pleasantly surprised in a disappointing way with his offense. They came in leading the OVC in scoring for a number of years. This year, they just have not been able to put the ball in the end zone to make Coach Webster a happy man.
All right, we will get you set for the opening kickoff in just a few moments. Now, time for the national anthem. RCA recording artist Kevon Edmonds, a native of Indianapolis, will sing it for us.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, where so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land
second annual Circle City Classic. Kickoff coming up. A&T, Tennessee State. We'll have it for you in just a few moments here on BET.
Today's Circle City Classic is brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Over 2,800 nonstop daily flights to 60 destinations all across the country. And by McDonald's. I'm loving it. and by Pontiac. 10 models, each one designed for action.
RCA Dome is jumping here in Indianapolis, Indiana, as we get ready to start the 22nd annual Circle City Classic. Now the third member of our broadcast team, Joe Torre, with a couple of celebrity guests. Joe?
Hey, what's happening, y'all? Standing here with my man, just sung the national anthem. Keep on, Evans. Kirk Franklin, bringing it in with the gospel, opening up the show, man. Hey, how's this feel to be at home singing Circle City Classic?
It's a wonderful feeling, man. It's a blessing to be back home, seeing all these wonderful people here in Indianapolis, supporting this. It's a wonderful event, and I'm just blessed to be a part of it, truly.
Blessed to have Kirk Franklin. How you feel, you know, bringing in the Circle City Classic with Jesus?
It's good to be here, man. We're grateful for the opportunity. I got my singers here. They did a great job today. So, you know, it's good seeing you, boy. It's good to be here with my people.
Now, can you play football?
Yeah.
I know you're a wrestler. Can you play?
Pardon me?
Can you play some football?
I can watch some football, baby.
All right. Exciting to be here with two national artists, y'all. Kirk Franklin, Kevon Edwards. Black college football, y'all. That's what it's all about. I'll see you later. We'll be back.
A&T won the toss and deferred to kick it to Tennessee State, and receiving on the near side is Jeremy Stevens. Stevens, a big hole across the 30. Stevens finally dragged down across midfield to the 47-yard line, a 48-yard return on the game's opening kickoff.
And that should have been a touchdown. You saw you had three TSU defenders against the kicker, but the kicker from A&T managed to wiggle in between the blockers and get that touchdown-saving tackle.
48 yards on the return, and the Tigers of Tennessee State in great field position for Andre Davis, 6 foot, 190-pound sophomore out of Nashville, has not thrown a pass this year, and his only collegiate pass came on a reverse, and he threw an interception. But they had a full contact scrimmage earlier this week. We'll get into that later. And Davis, this week anyway, won the starting quarterback job. Richard Gale is in motion to the far side, and Davis on the rollout. Davis throwing it behind his receiver. He was looking for Gale on that play. It'll be second down and 10. Here's a look at the Tennessee State back and receivers. Javaris Williams will start at tailback. He's their leading rusher. Gerald Morrow, one half of the Morrow brothers, the other half injured. We'll get into that a little bit later. Fred Burnett, their leading receiver. The offensive line is a nice group with a few changes in the offense this week, especially at center, with Phillip Baker getting the start in the middle this week. Get you the North Carolina A&T defense in just a second. Morrow in motion to the near side. Two receivers split down to the bottom of your screen. That's Gale out wide to the top. And now we have the play clock, I believe, getting down to zero. And that's going to be a delay of game penalty, and that's something you suffer with a young quarterback. So Andre Davis doesn't get the play call quick enough, I guess. Looking at the Aggie defense, Harrison, McLean, and Lewis. We'll call Lewis's name a lot. Milton, Jackson, and Daniels, the leaders at linebacker, and pretty good secondary with McBride, Weaver, Billingsley, and Theron Thomas. Out of the shotgun, quick swing pass over to Morrow, and Morrow with some room getting out of bounds at about the 43-yard line after a pretty decent pickup on the quick swing. 11 yards on that play, so it'll be third down and call it four. And James Webster talked about just hold on to the football. The mistakes have killed his team this year. Even though he's starting a sophomore quarterback, he feels that maybe this guy can protect the ball a little more and produce some points for him.
And that's one of the tough things when you have a quarterback in there, just because he can protect the football, not because he's the best passer.
Definitely more athletically gifted with the legs right now is Davis. And on the give, nice hold up the middle. Dancing his way through is Javaris Williams. Williams, their leading rusher, averaging 4.1 a carry, picks up 8 and moves the chains for the Tigers of Tennessee State.
And that's something that you expect Tennessee State to try and do, attack the North Carolina A&T defensive line. You saw Hampton earlier during the season come out and just rush for over 200 yards on them. So this A&T front is going to get tested by any team with the running game early on.
George Small, the head coach, just trying to ride out the storm right now. Suffered a lot of injuries the last 2 years, really. And trying to bring in the caliber of talent to really keep this program on top. Williams again off the left side. Nice hold. Gets down to about the 31. Give him a gain of close to 5 on the play.
You know, and the thing about A&T, you wonder, you know, why our team's able to run the ball off, because the strength of this defense for North Carolina A&T is in the linebackers. And anytime you've got your linebacker strength, which is always a good thing, but linebackers are, just by the nature of the game, 3 and 4 yards off the ball. You need your defensive front four to solidify the front to win the battle at the offensive line of scrimmage, so then the linebackers can make tackles. But if Tennessee State continues to rush for 5 yards a carry, it's going to be a long afternoon for North Carolina A&T fans.
Out of the shotgun formation, Davis with the play clock winding down. He better hurry, and I don't think he got it off in time. And for the second time on this drive, unless they gave him the timeout signal, he's going to be called for delay. Jay, let's start with Tennessee State. Your keys to victory, pretty simple for both teams.
Yeah, you know, what you got to do is you've got to be able to score points, and you got to force turnovers. These are two offenses that haven't been able to find their rhythm. For Tennessee State, they've got to be able to put up 14 points to get that great defensive chance. But on the defensive side of the ball, you got to force A&T to turn over the football. And if you look at North Carolina A&T's keys, they got the same keys.
Wow.
They've got to score points and force turnovers. And you can basically have those the keys for any game throughout the season.
Javaris Williams is stacked up right as he got that one. He might get back to the line of scrimmage on that play, so not much there. One of the people to bring him down, the linebacker Shamar Milton, one of the Dudley trio, they like to call him, from nearby Dudley High School in Greensboro, North Carolina. He leads the team in tackles with 37, 11 of them for a loss this year. So he makes things happen from that inside linebacker spot. On the third down and 11. Davis has blitzed heavily, got away from it, but white shirts all around him, and he outruns them, but finally is hit, and hit hard near the sideline, driven out of bounds and close to midfield, but there are flags on the play. Believe there was a little movement. Davis lost 13 yards trying to run away from the pressure. We'll see how they sort it out.
They'll get him for an illegal shift there. Hey, he protects the football. He didn't turn it over. And what you're going to see here, Davis, one thing about him, this is a design rollout. He's got great athleticism. Look at him outrun these guys. It takes 4 Aggie defenders in order to take him on the sideline. And what he's got to learn is, hey, avoid those hits to the quarterback. You're no good to the team on the sideline, as Tennessee State should know by having Rosser there on the sideline. But what you're seeing now early on is anytime you got a new quarterback in there, the Cajun doesn't have any type of rhythm. People are always moving, not getting set.
Montre Jackson was the first coming in on the blitz. He has 3 sacks. One of the co-leaders on this team. And in the cleanup on the sideline was Theron Thomas, another guy from Dudley High School.
See, right now, you see Tennessee State line up in punt formation. They have the ball on the 35-yard line. So what a disappointing series. And that's why the offense has not been productive this year. A good offense walks away with at least 3 points after that great kickoff and gaining the first down. A lackadaisical offense is punting the ball on 4th down.
Micah Stripe gets it inside the 10 and takes a pro A&T bounce. It'll be down at about the 17-yard line. A 30-yard punt with no return. The Circle City Classic just underway. We'll be right back. To go in the first quarter, A&T and Tennessee State scoreless in the 22nd annual Circle City Classic here in Indianapolis, Indiana. And there we go, the offensive unit for the Aggies of North Carolina A&T, Rico, they call him, Watkins, 14 of 30 this year, 121 yards, a touchdown and 2 picks, and on first down, the little reverse on the pitch. And now the pass wide open down the field, but overthrown, as on the reverse, Roderick Stevens, a backup quarterback, came into the game, and he had Curtis Walls all by himself down inside the 30 and overthrew it.
There was so much misdirection going on that he couldn't keep up with the wide receiver.
I look at the backs and receivers. Quante Spate, the starting back, and really, by default, he suffered so many injuries there, have the Aggies. They like to run over the left side with his senior offensive line unit, Cato and Gates, along that left side. Get to the Tennessee State defense in just a moment. Second down and 10, so they come out with some creativity. And Spate coming off the left side and taken down at about the 20-yard line. Boys blown dead right sacks after a pickup of about three. The defensive line for Tennessee State, Leonard Davis getting the start over Francie Dorleen, who I do see on the sideline. Duncan, Ernest Jones, and Jonathan Edwards there. Wesley Holmes, their leading tackler at the middle linebacker spot. Miguel Hall moves over from tight end to outside linebacker this week. And the secondary, Roger Strong. Landrum moves from linebacker back to Rover, and Justin Williams, the hard-hitting free safety. Third down and six out of the shotgun is Rico Watkins. Quick slant pattern. Has this man complete across the 30 to the 31-yard line. That's Douglas Brown, a pickup of 11. And Brown, the sixth all-time leader in Aggie receiving history, has been nursing a bad hamstring, but is still one of the leading pass catchers on this ball club.
You know, throughout Doug Brown's career, he's had a history of getting off to a slow start. Now the Aggie fans are getting excited. He had a nice breakout game last week, starting to get some catches, and him getting the catch on the first possession of the game here has to have the Aggie faithful excited.
Brown had three catches for 53 yards last week. Trying to battle off tackles, but he is met. Just as he got to the line of scrimmage, Jamar Landrum. And last week, North Carolina A&T did get off to a great start. Their first possession, they got five first downs last week against Elon, and the rest of the game, they only got eight.
That's what you call good coaching. Great game plan. It worked initially. If they make some changes and adjustments, we'll give Elon some credit for making some adjustments as well. But you can tell they prepare these boys. I mean, from the first play of the game, they had a guy wide open. Offense just didn't execute.
Three receivers split to the top of your screen, the far side right. Watkins out of the shotgun. On second and 10. Rolling that way. Throwing that way. Has his receiver out across the 35 to about the 37. And that's Brandon Trusty. Trusty, their leading receiver, coming into the game with five catches for 56 yards last week and 16, a team high coming into the season.
And if Rico Watkins can continue to make those type of plays, the simple throws, just complete them. The problem that you have with Rico Watkins is, just like with Tennessee State's facing, he turns over the football sometimes. He's a tall guy, 6'6", 220 pounds, tends to hold the football away from his body, making him a prime target for a strip.
Tigers showing blitz, and here they come.
Hands,
and hammered down, and losing the football was Watkins. He'll pick it up there. They battle for it in the scrum, and coming on the blitz that time was Jamar Landrum from that Rover position. And he just leveled Rico Watkins that time. I don't even think Watkins saw him coming, and he came from the front side.
Yeah, by Watkins being a left-handed quarterback, he's got to be able to see this. You'll see Landrum right here lining up. There's no doubt he's coming on the blitz. You wonder if the back misses protection. They did an inside stunt there, and Watkins was trusting his line was going to pick up the blitz with the switch, but they did not do it. That's just a tough hit right there for Watkins to have to take.
Now Landrum picking up his fourth sack of the season. And now punting. This is Morrow. Morrow loses the ball and gets it back. As he was hit, it came loose. And he recovered his own mishandle at the 27-yard line. 42-yard punt, minus two on the return. Today's coaches' quotes are brought to you by Pontiac, 10 models, each one designed for action. Coach James Webster talking to us a little bit earlier about the costly effect of turnovers, and you almost saw one there by Gerald Morrow.
I think the offense should be exciting, and I just want someone to protect the football. Protect the football, cut down on turnovers. I've told this football team, there is no one on our schedule that we can't beat, but we can beat ourselves. And that's what happened. In games that we've lost, we beat ourselves. And not taking anything away from teams, but had we not turned the football over, I think we had a different outcome.
Javaris Williams taking that one. Might have gotten back to the line of scrimmage. Didn't get much, however. So it'll be second and long for the Tennessee State Tigers offense, which you heard Coach hold on the ball. These turnovers are driving him crazy. Five lost fumbles so far this year. And eight interceptions. Minus eight turnover margin. That's two spots out of last out of the 116 teams.
second and 10. No gain on that play. Gale in motion. Two receivers split to the bottom of your screen near side. Running up the middle and getting brought down from behind before he could really get ahead of steam. That was Ricky Lewis. We told you we'd call his name a lot. One of the Dudley trio. 35 tackles from that defensive end spot and seven of them for a loss.
And what you're going to start to see is North Carolina A&T saw the game last week that Tennessee State had against Florida A&M. And they said they're going to bring outside pressure. Well, if you've got Ricky Lewis, who can almost be a stand-up defensive end linebacker, bringing the pressure from the outside, and Tennessee State's game plan is to try and roll outside the pocket, it's going to be an interesting matchup.
That'll be an official sack for Lewis, too. It was a loss of a couple and a direct snap. And boy, I tell you what, Andre Davis had a lot of room, but he looked like he ran into an official that time and went down. So the Tigers are going to be forced to punt. He looked like he might get first down yardage when he took off up the middle on that quarterback draw play. Instead, Tennessee State will be forced to punt. Micah Strife should strike this one from about his 20. And he's punting deep to Chaz Dawson. Chaz Dawson. Fair catch it at the 22-yard line. Actually, that's Trusty who fair caught it. 48-yard punt and no return. Today's coach's quotes brought to you by Pontiac. 10 models, each one designed for action. George Small we spoke to a little bit earlier, and it's got to be running back by committee a little bit, but he's trusting Quante Spate, his sophomore running back.
Try to keep motivating them, and hopefully he'll be hitting the right holes and making the correct breaks, you might say, and just encourage him to keep trying. And I know he had a 100-yard game last week, but, you know, he could have done so much better, you know, a play here, play there. And that's the level of consistency that we're looking for offensively overall.
One first down. And Spate got it. And there's still a lot of extracurricular activity going on out there on the field. But Spate did not get much, might have lost a yard or two on the play. 49 rushes coming into the day, averaging 5.4 yards a carry. Interesting story with this team. Hadn't had a 100-yard rusher in over a season, and now they've had one for three straight games.
Hey, they figured out how to run the football. And every now and then it can be simple. And if you got a running back averaging over 5.5 yards per carry, you tend to think he's going to get 100 yards. And if he doesn't, it's your fault because you're not giving him the football enough.
And the constant adjustments, it's a chess match in college football. And the Tigers on the sideline trying to make some adjustments. Another blitz. Got rid of it on the swing pattern. And brought down, we have a flag down on the play as well on the far side of the field. Rico Watkins swinging it out of the backfield. You call that earlier this season an extended handoff. Some of those safer passes in the call against the Aggies.
And those plays can be very effective when you got blitzing teams, especially teams that like to bring pressure around the perimeter. They bring an outside rush, outside linebacker to come and blitz the quarterback. You send the running back out his direction. You put that linebacker in a bind. Is he going to continue with his blitz, or is he going to peel off and cover the running back on the outside?
He gained maybe 2 yards on that play, and Wesley Holmes signaling to his coach Webster, and let's decline that.
Legal block in the back. Number 10 of the offense. Penalty is declined. It'll be third down.
I'm a little surprised you declined that penalty. I mean, you've got a defense that's playing great, and true, you want to get them off the field as quickly as possible, give them third and eight. But in this type of game where field position is going to be crucial, why not back them up closer to their goal line and give your offense a better chance at having good field position when they get the ball back?
Let's go, team!
It'll be third and seven. And Watkins operating out of the shotgun with all three receivers split to the near side. Quarterback draw. Watkins showing a burst of speed, getting very close to first down yardage. And I think they gave him a nice spot. He'll get it, and they'll move the chains for the Aggies of North Carolina A&T.
They say it looked like the referee showed him some love.
Showed him a little love on
they
that
gave
one.
Him a good spot. You'll see the quarterback draw then. A good job by Rico getting through the hole. He's 6'6", so he really had to get some leg lift there. And they gave him a good spot there for a first down. But good job protecting the football and showing some athleticism.
senior unit on the offensive line. We asked Coach, who's your best offensive lineman? He couldn't name one because of the inconsistent play from his entire offensive unit this year. And again, all seniors up front. This is Spate. A nice hole off the far side. Spate still on his feet. Reverses his field. It's a foot race. He'll be down at the 9-yard line after 58 yards. Landrum saying the touchdown.
You see why Spade is averaging 5.5 yards per carry. That'll help the average right there. The great vision. Looked like nothing was there. And then all of a sudden, you just saw the strength of this running back. Going there to the right side, looking. Nothing's there. Go through some tackles. And then the serious cutback across field. Switch the ball on the outside elbow there, showing good technique. And it's a foot race. And I'm going to tell you, no problem getting tracked down by Jamar Landrum. He can run. So it's not like he was a slow guy there. But I like how these arm tackles don't bring him down. Good running backs don't get tackled by arm tackles. They get tackled by shoulders. And then he turned on the jet there, had the wherewithal to keep going.
Quante Spate, correction, 57 yards on that run. And now Watkins going to keep it. This looks like a totally designed run play, and he is smacked down hard on the far side of the field. A big fella at 6'6", you're lucky because you don't like a quarterback getting smacked around like that on those run plays.
You know, taking hits unnecessarily in that case. What you like to see him do at some point, decide you're going to cut and run upfield. He kept running sideways, let the defense stretch him all the way to the sideline. Last time I checked, sideline didn't miss too many tackles. Take the ball up in there. That's what you got the 6'6 frame for. Lean forward and get some positive yards.
Coach Smalls trying to design a way to get his team into the end zone here in the first quarter. After that nice run by Quante Spate, and here he is again on the delay, and Spate gets inside the 5, down to about the 4, so it'll be 3rd and goal for the Aggies.
When you see Coach Small, I mean, he said, don't let our record fool you. I mean, we fully intend on competing for this MEAC championship. You know, we took the loss to Hampton. That's our only conference loss we have. So they think they can go out there and compete for this title. And they also said, you know, they better get me now. You know, you better get me now. True, we got a senior offensive line, but I've got some babies that are coming along that I recruited a couple years ago. They're going to carry this A&T program for years to come.
Asking for what every coach wants is Coach Small. A little patience. And Sean Butch, here comes Landrum again, and Watkins going to walk in all alone off the right side. Somebody forgot to cover number 15.
Hey, that's what happens sometimes. Teams get so locked up in trying to play this red zone coverage where you got man-to-man coverage. Well, who's going to count for the quarterback? And it was an overshift and good recognition by Watkins.
I mean, this is a guy who has pretty good legs as well. You figure somebody would be checking it.
You know, it's not like a small target. How do you miss a guy 6'6" on the football field?
So the quarterback keeper of 4 yards puts A&T on top 6-0, pending the extra point of Joseph Arroyo. And Arroyo is true on that one. So the Aggies of North Carolina A&T, thanks to a 57-yard run by Quante Spate, get the touchdown and lead it 7-0.
You are now free to move about the country.
3:44 to go here in the first quarter of the Circle City Classic. A&T leading 7-0. Looking at the NCAA Hall of Fame, and now we'll look for Joe Torre, who is looking for the best-dressed football fan. Joe.
Jay, what's up, man? I'm out here on the plaza looking for the best dress or the most unique outfit. So I'm going to be coming back and forth finding them because Indiana got some colors and some fashions going on. I'm going to show you what I'm talking about for a football game. We'll be back with some of that, all right? See you later.
All right, so Joe, his assignment, should he decide to accept it?
All he has to do is look at us in the pregame. We came up here styling a little bit. We're football fans, you know.
Yeah. I guess we get in a different category, though, since... You know, we're broadcasting the game, so maybe we don't count. 7 plays, 78 yards, and 2:43 before Watkins' 4-yard
run. See that Aggie pride? You see that Aggie pride?
Can you give me one?
Let me get a little Aggie pride on for you. 1, 2, 3.
Aggie
pride? You talk about a proud football program.
Yes.
No matter what the records may be, these A&T folks love their North Carolina Aggies.
Denard Cox is on the far side, top of your screen, and a little... Short kickoff, it comes down to Jeremy Stevens, and Stevens, with a flag down, gets out to the 25-yard line. And that usually means an illegal block on the return team of some kind. Stevens Dolphins had that nice opening kickoff return, got into A&T territory, but they weren't able to score.
Yeah, you saw much better coverage by the North Carolina A&T kickoff team there. You know, Stevens there, they tried to put some serious wood on him on that return. You know, you go out there and you embarrass the kickoff team, coverage team, you got it the first time, but we don't let it happen again.
Illegal block in the back, number 33 of the return team penalized 10 yards. Be first down.
3:36 to go in the first quarter. Tennessee State trying to answer North Carolina A&T's 7-0 lead.
Why take your family to a casual dining restaurant and pay $8 a person when you can get the same quality meal for half the price at KFC? Get 10 pieces of Kentucky Fried Chicken, 2 large home-style sides, and 4 biscuits for less than $4 a person. Your dollar goes further at KFC.
The closer I get to you,
the more you make me smile.
Imagine a dental plan that performs when you need it. Crest Whitening Plus Scope, now in new Citrus Splash.
Make me smile.
Crest Whitening Plus Scope.
3:36 to go in the first. Jay Walker, Joe Torre, Eric Clemens, happy to bring you this 22nd annual Circle City Classic. Javaris Williams spinning out over the 20 to the 21-yard line. So give him a pickup of 6 on the play. I'll call it 5.
And they're going to need productivity on first down in order to help this first-time starting quarterback.
Today's Circle City Classic is brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Over 2,800 nonstop daily flights to 60 destinations all across the country. Second and 4. Andre Davis rolling out under some pressure. He's in trouble, and down he goes. He just had nowhere to go with that one. And he was brought down by Marquez Ruffin. Backup safety man coming in from the free safety spot.
You know, see, what they're going to tell, what they're not going to let Davis do is get outside the pocket. So, you know, when you talk to the coaches in the pregame, I talked to the defensive coordinator, Lonzo Lee, North Carolina A&T, said, we're going to pressure from the outside. And then when I talked to the offensive coordinator for Tennessee State, they're saying, well, we got to make sure we get Davis out of the pocket, roll out. I was like, this formula doesn't, something's going to happen. Something's got to give. And right now the A&T defense is having their way.
Lost 11 yards on that play, and on third down he tries to keep it in again. The quarterback takes a nice, a hard hit. Helmets lost. You can hear that smack all the way up here.
You know, you say it over and over again, there's nothing like game reps. You get a quarterback in there starting for the first time, and the exchange is on the quarterback. On the quarterback's in exchange. This is something you've been doing since elementary school, but you get here and you get nerves and you start bobbling the ball around. You get discombobulated a little bit because you're just caught up in the ambience. I mean, just think about it. Your first start is on national TV in front of 60,000 folks here in the NFL stadium. We were nervous.
When that helmet shot off, I thought it was the ball for a minute. Did he throw the ball to the official?
Thank goodness there was no head up in that helmet when it came out of there.
Trusty is back. He's fair catching this one, and not a fortuitous Tennessee State bounce, and it's finally downed at the 41-yard line. So A&T has another excellent opportunity after only the 25-yard punt to go in and add to their 7-0 lead with a minute 24 to go here in the first. James Webster not getting much out of his offense once again, and now he's going to have to call on his defense to come up with something big to keep A&T off the board here.
Yeah, you know, and you want your defense to be on the field. You know, if you're a defensive-minded coach and you got a great defense, you want your defense to be on the field, but you don't want them to be on the field when A&T's got the ball on the 35-yard line going in. So put your defense at a real disadvantage. But this is a measure of a defense. If they can hold A&T to just 3 points or not allow them to get in field goal position, you can tell how great this defense could be.
Three receivers split to the bottom of the screen, and this is Spates avoiding a tackle at the line of scrimmage and then squirting forward inside the 35 to the 33. So it'll be a pickup of about 4 on the play and create second down and, well, maybe a long 6, maybe close to 7.
And they're going to need Spate to stay on the field today. Like, you know, they've got Michael Ferguson in there. Call him Michael Freshman. He's a freshman. And he missed. He was the one that got beat earlier, Ferguson, on that blitz pickup there. So Spate's got to stay on the field, not just only for his running the ball, but in terms of the blocking scheme. See, that's what a lot of people don't realize. You know, playing running back is one thing, but when you don't have that football, you got to be the quarterback's next line of defense.
And we have flags on the play. Play clock went down to 0.
still second down.
Now we've seen this on both sides of the football. And Coach Small looking a little confused about it all. How come we can't get a play in time? Rico Watkins, a senior quarterback.
That's one of the things you were thinking, though. Although Rico is the senior quarterback, you know, this is his first start on the season. So Marshall Glenn has been the starter, but he's lost his job to Rico Watkins. And, you know, think about it, you know, Roderick Stevenson, we saw throw the first pass of the game, the junior college transfer. So they're still not settled at the quarterback position, too. And anytime you play quarterback shuffle, you know, you don't have efficient offenses.
This is a team that has been in just about every game they have played in.
I don't know about that.
They played just about okay. Every game.
Say, those Pirates put some on them.
They lose by one, and then by two, and then by three in their three losses this year. Here's Watkins on the little rollout, and he's going to keep it and get inside the 40 to about the 38-yard line. They did lose to Hampton 31-14 after they called off the dogs for a little bit. Hampton a 28-0.
Hampton do that to a lot of people, right. So you can't really blame them for that one.
But they have been on the wrong end of some close losses all year long, and Coach Small just said, hey, we got to be patient here as we end the first quarter. 7-0, A&T with the lead and the ball, third and long, when we come back for the 22nd annual Circle City Classic here in Indianapolis.
This portion of the Circle City Classic is brought to you by Jeep. Trail-rated capability. Only in a Jeep 4x4.
Second quarter underway. BET Soundstage getting everybody hyped up for the 22nd Circle City Classic here in Indianapolis. A&T facing a fourth down situation, leading 7-0. And they are going to go for it. It'll be fourth and about five.
The most dangerous man on the field is right there.
Gonna keep it. Gonna make the first down. Did he lose the football?
He might have recovered it, but
I think he did reach back and grab it. Yep, they say A&T keeps the ball. And boy, I tell you, he showed some great patience when waiting for his hole to open up on that run.
He set up his blockers, but the problem with Rico, you're 6'6", you got long arms. You got to tuck that ball closer to your body. Teams know that. You've got a tendency to fumble, so you should be running the ball with two hands every opportunity you get instead of the one hand. But at least he had the wherewithal to recover his own mishap.
Today's first quarter stats brought to you by McDonald's. I'm loving it. In the first quarter, the Aggies control 92 total yards to only 11 for Tennessee State. First down and 10. Spate spun around after picking up maybe a yard on the play off the left side.
Tough running there. You know, you talk about the senior playing the offensive line. You know, Chris Gates is one of those guys that's got the NFL kind of watching for him. They think he can be a pro, legitimate pro prospect. He's got good size, been a four-year starter down there for North Carolina A&T. So if you're going to run the football, that's where you want to run it behind.
Francie Dorleen won that battle at the line of scrimmage and made the tackle. The 6'4", 260-pound senior. And Gates, we talked about him. They like to run off that left side with Gates and Cato. And a nice spin move. Getting away from initial contact. Picking up more positive yardage was Fate once again. Today's trivia question brought to you by Jeep. Trail-rated capability only in a Jeep 4x4. The question is, and you name the only person in the MEAC to earn a conference championship as both a player and a coach.
I know that one. Well, I didn't even know the question, but that's a good one. That's not that tough, either.
No.
You know the answer?
Yes.
You read the call.
Only because I worked. Third and five. Little swing, nice one-handed catch, and losing his balance that time was Spade out of the backfield, and he had a lot of room to run down the near side.
And it's little things like that as a quarterback that you have to take the blame for. If you give him a nice catchable pass, lead him downfield so he can catch that ball in stride, he could have ran that ball to the end zone possibly. But just because you threw that ball about a yard behind him, Spade did a great job of making the one-handed catch, but he had to turn his whole body around. Now you come up with a critical fourth down. Little things like that in football just drive offensive coordinators crazy. It could be the difference in a victory or a loss.
And going to discuss things with the coaches on the sideline. What do you do on fourth and short? We'll find out in a moment.
ESI, it's the cola.
A&T facing a fourth down and short, leading 7-0 over Tennessee State. And last week, the Battle of the Bands winner was the marching force of Hampton University. You can log on to www.bet.com/BCF after today's game to cast your vote for your favorite band of the week and tune in next week for the winner.
I mean, that's tough enough. Their football team is probably going to beat you. And now their band probably going to beat you, too. I tell you, Hampton's just living it up right now, aren't they?
Halftime, the blue and gold marching machine of A&T against the Aristocrat Bands from Tennessee State. 33-yard field goal attempt by Joseph Arroyo from the near hash or the right hash. And Arroyo got it through. So from 33 yards, Arroyo moves to 2-for-3 from 30 to 39 yards this season, and A&T has taken a 10-0 lead in the game.
And just think, go back to that third down pass. If Watkins gives him a catchable ball, you get the first down, you're possibly driving in for a touchdown. Instead, that's what we mean by you have to settle for 3 points, when they just as easily could have gotten the touchdown had they been able to keep the drive alive. But the offense is learning. You got to take the positive, and anytime you put points on the board, don't let me be too negative. In the game of football, in any sport, putting points on the board is what it's all about. So 3 points, 7 points is better than zero any day.
After every score, and that is a tough job. I don't know if anybody has ever tried to carry one of those heavy flags and run down the field with it, but that's tough.
Yeah, he does 100 yards, and then with the band, boy, they heat it up here.
I still think the push-ups for every point are the toughest.
I think the only school still doing that is military academy.
Right.
They need to do some push-ups to lift. You know, we're talking about, you know, Circle City, and for years, you know, this, and it still is, the biggest classic game you can go to that doesn't involve rival teams. You know, every year they bring in different teams from around the country. You know, the Bayou Classic is going to be those two Louisiana teams. Magic City is going to be those two Alabama teams. And the Florida Classic is going to be the Joe Cook and FAMU. But this game right here is still the preeminent black college game in terms of attendance. And any team can go there on different years. They vary up the teams every year. And it's just a great environment for a black college football classic.
High short kickoff and comes down. And there he is again, Stevens, with a nice hole and a nice run back out across the 40 to the 42. Joe Torre, his mission today to find the best-dressed college football fan. And, Joe, I think he has one.
Hey, y'all, I'm here with Liz, and I think she's going to win best dress because that's how you dress for a football game. You know what I'm saying? Nothing too cute. She's ready, got her FUBU jersey on, y'all. She looking hot, matched down to the tennis shoes, glasses, lipstick. She got it all popping.
All together.
You know what I'm saying? She ready to yell, scream, spill stuff on her shirt. That's what I'm talking about. She may just win. We'll see that. We'll see. All right.
She wasn't bad looking either, which might have been the reason he picked her.
Yeah, I was noticing that, yeah, too.
First and 10. Tennessee State needing to do something. They have been outscored 34-0 in the quarter, and here's looking deep, and he finds his man, Burnett. And Burnett has the reception down to the 40-yard line, 18 yards, and he threw a strike on that pass.
He did, and more importantly, I mean, look at the offensive protection that offensive line did up front. You got to give them credit. You know, the makeshift offensive line they've got, they haven't been able to run the ball, but they sure are doing a good job on pass protection. He had all day back there to throw the ball. And as a quarterback, when your line gives you that much time, you got to find a completion.
18 yards on that hookup. So their leading receiver, Fred Burnett, came in with 16 catches on the year for 210 yards. And out of the shotgun, Andre Davis. And he looked for Burnett that time. Dangerously, it went off his right hand and floated in the air a bit. Could have been picked off. And instead, it touches the field turf harmlessly, incomplete.
You know, and every time A&T is getting to the quarterback, where's it coming from? It's not coming up the middle. It's coming from the outside. Coming from the outside. So how do you attack a team that's sending a lot of pressure from the outside? Some draws, some counteraction. You know, let them think they can beat you upfield. Then have one of those home run hitters you have at running back take it to the house when they come in there a little bit too fast.
Denard Cox is the setback in motion, going out to the far side. And Davis alone in the backfield. Morrow on the inside reverse. And Morrow has some room. First down yardage, perhaps, depending on the spot. Give him 9 on the play. They'll spot him a yard short. So it'll be 3rd and short. And they used this play a lot when we saw him the first time this year, and then pretty successfully.
Yeah, you know, Coach Webster said at the beginning of the year, what I learned about my team early on was the Morrow twins are my best football players I have on offense. Well, now you're down to a Morrow twin instead of twin, but you still got to continue to get the ball to your playmakers. And every time the Morrows touch the ball, good things tend to happen for the Tennessee State Tiger offense.
Boy, only 5'7", 165 pounds of both of them. Jared, of course, lost for the year with a shoulder injury. And going up the middle at running back by committee, K.J. Austin Bruce gets first down yardage. And they'll use a lot of guys. Williams, Bruce, Denard Cox, you've seen. Maurice Young is nursing an injury. But we saw them use 4 people in the halfback position the first time they were here on BET.
Man, where is Charles Anthony when you need him? They can coach tell you in a minute. I would settle for just 1 Charles Anthony.
2,000 yards, he told us earlier this week, 1,900 of them he got on his own, Coach said. And there's Bruce once again, and Bruce dragging some tacklers inside the 25 to the 24. Charles Anthony, let's see what old number 22 looked like last year, and he was, well, all world.
So he was special. He was one of those guys that he just made people miss all the time, and he's one of the best runners in the history of 1AA football. You see here all those extra yards he was getting. No one man could bring Charles Anthony down. And the Tennessee State Tigers, they got a little spoiled having him back there. Not only could he run the football, but he had great vision. He's such an athlete. The ball's deflected, tipped. Here he is catching the game-winning touchdown reception. So he was an all-around great running back for Tennessee State.
Cox is in motion to the near side, bottom of your screen. And 2 people in motion at once, plus the play clock went out. So.
False start. Number 85, offense, penalized 5 yards. Still 2nd down.
And that's not really their fault there. I mean, you know, you saw that the tight end Eddie Woods and the guy, they saw the play clock was going to 0. And they tried to just anticipate the quarterback was going to snap the ball before it got to 0. So what you got to do is you got to tell Andre Davis back there in the huddle, hey, settle down. The play clock is there. You at least got to call the ball, get the ball snapped before the whistle blows. So Davis is still unsettled in his cage. He's got to calm down and get this offense up and lined up where they need to be.
2nd and 13, Andre Davis alone in the shotgun and the quarterback draw. And Davis gets down to about the 27-yard line. Now, next week, it's our final game of the season, believe it or not, here on BET, and it couldn't be a better one. The Tuskegee Morehouse Classic from Columbus, Georgia. Broadcast time here on BET is 7:30 next Saturday night. Looking forward to that one. J.D. Washington, Denzel's boy, a senior running back now, and a very talented one, so looking forward to seeing that.
I mean, he's a player. You know, yes. Don't let the name fool you. You know, he is a straight-up football player. Even if his last name was Smith, we'd still be talking about
Washington, Lincoln, Smith. He can play. He has a very elusive quality. And there's a ball picked up by A&T. Will anybody catch Lewis?
Rumble, young man, rumble.
I like the catch. I like the cut. He's in.
I like the cut. D lineman's dream. A D lineman's dream is to get that type of play. And he not only perfected it, he got the touchdown. He had a little celebration and stuck it out there too. Ricky Lewis showing the Jets.
6'3", 245 pounds. Very versatile defensive end. You talked about him earlier. He can stand up and do anything, and he proves that time when he got the football, he can also run 70 yards on the fumble return for the touchdown, and the Aggies of A&T have added to their lead at
16-0.
And it's not supposed to happen. You know, when defensive linemen or defensive linebackers score a touchdown, you know, 20, 30 yards, not 70, because 70 yards means everybody in the offense had a chance to go catch him.
And he just outran all of them.
Arroyo on for the extra point. Uh-oh, and that's a bad snap, so Arroyo,
oh,
he loses that one. And it's still loose out there. Looks like more of a rugby match right now. So the extra point will be no good on the bad snap. But the Aggies of North Carolina A&T strike on the 70-yard fumble return and lead it 16-0 in the second.
Also check out Color Radiance.
A&T leading 16-0 thanks to the fumble return of Ricky Lewis, 70 yards. Extra point was missed, and turnovers have been an epidemic for James Webster's team all year long. Alabama State, the end zone late, and the fumble here against Jackson State. Recovered by the Tigers of Jackson State, and FAMU going in, last play of the game, intercepted at the goal line, and this one today. That's a botched handoff, and Ricky Lewis, Johnny on the spot. All he's got to do is outrun a couple would-be tacklers, and he goes 70 yards for the touchdown. And that's the worst penalty you can play on a turnover when it results in immediate points for your opponent.
You know, and we talked about how they're 114th in the nation in the turnover margin. Well, they may be 115 right now. But I guarantee you that team that's at 115, they're working on holding on to football right now.
Stevens on the kick return gets it out across the 25 before a host of white shirts stack him up. And they're still kind of scrumming down there. And you figure a whistle would have blown by now to break things up. 16-0, A&T leading Tennessee State. Here in the second quarter, Tennessee State has to do something to answer it fast. First down and 10 for Tennessee State's Tigers. And they give Javaris Williams out across the 30. And a lot of extracurricular activity still going on between these two. And you talk about it, you've played in games where you've had a big lead on somebody, the frustration starts to set in, and you get a few extra blows or a few extra blocks to the head that you don't like, and then stuff starts to happen.
Yeah, and I was wondering, you know, the officials here have to do a good job of clamping down on this. I mean, the game, you got two teams going out there giving it all. They haven't had a great season. One team is starting to pull away from the other. You got to grasp, you know, you got to bear down, because they're starting to do some late hits after the whistle and not playing between the whistles like they're supposed to. So the officials have to get a little bit more involved in that aspect of this football game.
Janaris Williams stacked up that time. I don't think he got beyond the line of scrimmage. Host of white shirts there to meet him as soon as he got it and bring him down for no gain.
At one point, you know, if you're Tennessee State, I mean, you're down by 16. You know you don't score a lot of points. You know, when do you contemplate making a quarterback change? You know, you haven't been able to run the ball like you want to, and you've got, you know, the quarterback who's your passer, Hartman, on the sideline. I think it's time for Coach Webster to think about, you know, getting Hartman off the bench to throw the football, because Davis hasn't shown that he can, you know, move the team down there throwing the football. He's got great legs. It's his first start. He may be a little rattled. You may have to settle him down.
Third down in the game. And this is Cox. And Cox tried to get the corner, but he couldn't shake off a final tackle, so it'll be brought down at the 35, a couple yards short of a first down. And trailing by 16 is this territory, Coach, where you might go for it. If you don't make it, though, A&T has great field position. I think you'd almost have to punt him.
Yeah, if you don't make it, you know, you're probably down by more than three touchdowns. So I think you got to punt the ball away. And Lehe, you know, if he had an offense that was efficient, moving the ball, possibly, yes. But when your defense is the best part of your football team, you got to give them every opportunity to win the game for you.
Right now,
the Tennessee State offense is an offensive liability. You know, they're giving points to the other team, so any chance you can to get it out of their hands, which is unfortunate, you got to put your defense on the field.
Micah Stripe has that one blocked, and it will bounce along the near side. It'll still go for positive yardage on the punt.
I
give
them
about 4 yards.
I told you they should have went for it. You're going to get the punt block. You should have gone for it.
Micah Strive had that one deflected. And one of the keys on that play was Brandon Colbert. And Joe Torre, the third member of our broadcast team, down on the sidelines with more. Joe?
What's happening here with the Kid Capri?
What up?
You know everything about beats and bands. What you think gonna happen at the Hat Off in your halftime battle of the bands?
Well, halftime, I'm coming to make it hot. I'm gonna put the Kid Capri on them. I think the band's gonna come up and make it crazy. I'm gonna sit around and wait and see how that go through. Every year we here. This is the fifth year I've been here, and it's crazy every year. Big shout to my man Amp Harris. Word up.
Okay, y'all. Aristocrats, or it's gonna be the Marching Machine. We don't know, but Kid, I know they can't hang with you because you got too many beats.
I mean, I'm acting crazy out there. I'm gonna bring the party right here to the field.
All right, y'all. We see you, Eric Jenkins. You happening down here, baby.
Now, Joe, you know you're not supposed to let him get away without saying, this is the Kid Capri, Capri, Capri.
We got our own echo up here in the booth, folks. And you can remember to log on to www.bet.com/BCF and log your votes after the game for your favorite band. The Battle of the Bands at the half. Blue and Gold Marching Machine of A&T against the Aristocrat of Bands for Tennessee State. That's coming up. It ought to be happening here at the Circle City Classic. Second down, call it five. And unfortunately, keeping it on the rollout was Watkins, who lost his footing on the field turf at the 45-yard line. That'll be minus 10 yards, and it'll go as a sack for Tennessee State.
Been one of those tight seasons for Tennessee State, huh? You know your offense ain't doing nothing when your band is falling asleep on you.
Third down and 15. Rico Watkins operating out of the shotgun with two receivers split to the bottom of your screen, near side, one to the top. On the draw. Spate picked up about four, where they'll be about 11 yards short of the first down. That might have been Ferguson. Michael Ferguson, the true freshman there. Today's Scholastic Athletes of the Game brought to you by Pepsi. It's the cola. Fred Burnett of Tennessee State, a senior, a 3.2 GPA in special education, and Brian Johnson of A&T, 3.7 GPA in economics. How do you say economics?
I like that Brian Johnson, that 3.7 counting them Benjamins, baby. He majored in econ. He's counting them Benjamins with 3.7. You better give him his proper change every time.
Dominique Brown going to try to cough and corner this one. And, oh, it was missed there. The gunner down, coming down on the far side, had an opportunity to down that one inside the 5-yard line, but just missed it. And we got a flag down on the field as well. Let's see what they sort out here. And Tennessee State applauding in approval.
Illegal shift on the offense.
Penalty will be declined, unless you want to give him an opportunity to punt it again and
right.
Maybe pin you inside the 20. I don't know.
Justin Williams was back deep to receive it. They didn't expect.
The penalty is declined. It'll be first and 10.
They didn't expect to punt that time. They expected them maybe to do something on fourth down and short. Second quarter action continuing. 3:21 to go. A&T leading by 16. .21 to go in the first half. The Aggies of North Carolina A&T leading 16-0 here in the Circle City Classic. And earlier today, Kirk Franklin.
Turn it up. Woo! It's your boy, Kirk Franklin.
One more time. If you don't mind, can you clap with me? Just one time. Listen to this. Remember this.
Kirk Franklin entertaining the fans here at the RCA Dome. More of him a little bit later on. Tennessee State, bad possessions, punt, 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 fumble, return for a touchdown, and a block punt. And let's see what Andre Davis can do on possession number six. Roll it out. In some trouble. Coming back the other way. Has some room. Going back the other way. And a block. That's the athleticism Coach Webster talked to us about. Andre Davis, 33 yards, and we have a flag on the play at the A&T 40-yard line.
Man, what the feeling it must be to have those fresh legs. I mean, you know, he ran all the way to the sideline, and he actually ran probably 50 yards for the 33-yard game. But, you know, the being a mobile quarterback is just one of those things. It's a blessing if you got it.
And I tell you, I thought they had him in the backfield for another potential sack, and he easily got away from the defenders who had him surrounded there as he rolled out to the far side. And Coach Webster chewing out Chris Johnson, it looks like, on the sideline there, who might have done something illegal as his quarterback was running.
At the end of the play, we have two fouls, dead ball, personal foul. Number 43 of the defense, dead ball, personal foul. Number 5 of the offense, those penalties cancel. First and 10.
You know, what you got now is Coach Webster just schooling him a little bit. You know, you got Chris Johnson, the freshman, getting in there. He's got a great play. You know, we don't need the stuff going on at the end of this. But look at the good job by Davis of cutting all the way against the field. And I want you to see the block he's going to get from the Morrow brother right there. That block right there helps spring him for an additional 15 yards right there. So good job by the wide receiver blocking downfield. You know, you can tell they've been building up for these personal fouls. After every play, you know, you got people pushing. And you knew it was coming sooner or later. Now, maybe with the flag being thrown, the team just settle down and just play football, boys.
And Burnett throwing that block down 82, and then they passed to the near side for Morrow, incomplete. But needless to say, a good athletic play by Andre Davis, who again, as we talked about earlier, won that battle in the live scrimmage and earned the starting spot today over Richard Hartman, who has been nursing several injuries anyway, knee, back, and elbow. I mean, he's got a lot of bumps and bruises. So they really need the young quarterback to step in and step up and play well.
Yeah, I mean, it was an interesting thing. I mean, Hartman was banged up. So it came down between Andre Davis and Gerald Cook. And Coach Webster didn't have the belief in either one of these young men, you know, in terms of who the starter could be. So what he decided to do is say, we're going to have a live scrimmage, and whoever plays the best in the scrimmage will start on Saturday.
On near side, throwing near side, and that one is complete. Morrow has it before he steps out of bounds for 12 yards at the 35-yard line. First down, move the sticks for Tennessee State. And Andre Davis, you saw the close-up of those eyes. They were big, and they were looking at everything. That might be a little nervousness, being a little young, but he certainly is more confident running that ball than he's throwing.
It's like my mentor James Harris once told me, it's all right to be nervous, you just can't be scared.
Okay.
If you're nervous, it's natural to get nervous. But if you're scared, then we got to talk about it. We got a problem.
Gerald Morrow coming into the game with 11 catches, 17.3 yard average per reception. And we get a little movement on the interior of the line. Looked like Damian Pitts might have come out of his stance a little early for Tennessee State. And as they sort it out, let's get the call.
False start. Number 70 offense. Penalized 5 yards. Still first down.
Coming up on the Southwest Airlines Halftime Report, we'll feature the Battle of the Bands. Jay and I will have the first half highlights and stats for you. All that coming up at the half here on Black College Football on BET. High formation behind Davis, and that gave us to K.J. Austin Bruce. And Bruce gets inside the 40 to the 39-yard line. So it'll be second and call it 14 now after a pickup only of one.
I've been really impressed with the way this North Carolina A&T defense is attacking the football. You know, they've been beat on a couple plays. They had the long run early. They got beat on. But the fact is, you know, these guys are really coming out here, and they're attacking the football. And at 1-3, that's not easy to do. You start to want to finger point, you know, at the offense and say they can't do this. But this linebacker corps for A&T is really attacking the football every single play.
Double tight end set.
And let him go.
Looking deep. Laser is intercepted. He threw it right into the hands of the free safety, Deron Thomas. And Thomas tripped up at the 26-yard line on the return. And Tennessee State
after the 17-yard return, squanders another opportunity to try to get some points on the board.
And that's just one of those cases where you've got a young quarterback not reading his first key. First thing you're taught in the game of football as a quarterback is find where your safeties are. When you break the huddle, you look for the safeties. The safeties are going to tell you everything. And if you know where the safeties are, you can know the coverage. If the free safety picks you off, that means you're not reading anything. So you take a look at his eye. The play action might have he lost contact with the free safety there. But this ball, the moment he threw it, was trouble. Free safety sitting right there waiting for the football. It was a good job of Thomas. But I like it when you get a DB. Go for an aggressive run because wide receivers aren't used to tackling people. They're used to getting hit, not hitting people. So a good job on the return by Thomas as well.
Montez Spate trying to get the corner to the near side, and he is hit out of bounds, and do get a flag. Yeah, he was hit by a couple of blue jerseys long after he crossed the white line and got out of bounds. So that'll be a personal foul penalty against Tennessee State.
And that's one of those frustration things, you know. They're running the ball, and the corner came from all the way on the other side of the field.
Personal foul, late hit out of bounds. Number 51 of the defense. Penalized 15 yards. Automatic first down.
That was Carl Buford on the late hit. They take one more look at it.
See, I don't think it was Buford. I mean, they called 51, but I actually think it was Aaron Strong, the cornerback down there. He's down there laying up, so they called Buford. Buford's hit was inbounds. Strong came in there with the 1-2. You know, Buford might have been close, but when Strong came and just put the exclamation point on it, you got to flag back.
Tennessee State, 6 penalties for 46 yards on the day. And a frustrating one it is, or it has been so far in the first half, for Coach James Webster.
And all these late hits and personal fouls are not a good representation for your university.
Play clock winding down. They get it off in time and on the play fake. And down he goes as Rico Watkins thought maybe it was going to be a little easier to get away from Wesley Holmes than he imagined. So Holmes gets the sack, 10 yards on the loss.
Yeah, and that can't happen. I mean, that can happen. He had plenty of time to either throw the football away or, you know, run the ball. He tried to juke and get too fancy with it. Now you're looking at second and 20, which more than likely you won't get this first down. Seen stranger things. Maybe another quarterback draw here. Maybe I don't know what I'm talking about up here, but the term that you just don't like to see, you get a sack on first down.
Second down, a little draw play. And Spate bouncing off tackles. Still bouncing and battling his way across the 45 to the 46-yard line. He picked up 9 on the play. So it'll be third down and long. Call it about 11 yards to go for first down.
This is one of the things where does Coach Small have the confidence in his offense to throw the ball on third down? Been very conservative play calling. And, you know, both coaches came in here and said we have to hold on to the football. You know, this is one of those times where they call the draw plays, you know, but I'd like to see him just let it go downfield.
Spade, 87 yards rushing and only 11 carries here in the first half. 57 coming on one play off the play fake. Watkins stepping up, throwing it away to the near side. And he did something else just to get that one away. He was looking for his fullback, Michael Christen, who swung out of the backfield. It'll be fourth and 11. And with 37 seconds to go in the half, A&T very comfortable punting it away.
Don't get too comfortable because you got Morrow back there. You know, Jared can he can take this thing to the house there. So you got to really cover up. And he's an exciting punt returner as well. So you got to make sure you have solid special teams coverage on this punt.
I'm Dominique Brown. I don't even kick it at him. I aim toward the sideline, averaging almost 17 yards a return as Morrow. He's going to get a high one. And Morrow got to field it and call for the fair catch at the 17-yard line. 36-yard punt, no return. I don't know. I like to think you got a guy with the ability of Morrow. You know, your team's down 16. You need a big play. Catch it and try to do something with it.
Yeah, but you know, I think what happened is they went for the punt block. So when you go for the punt block, you don't have anybody blocking for you. They're trying to block. So, you know, you kind of instruct your returner, hey, you only return it if you get one of those line drive type kicks. And with the punt hanging there, he might have got his clock.
You quarterbacks see everything.
You know,
I'm watching the ball come down to the deep man receiving. I don't see a punt block.
Scanning the field. Like anything, you see it, you see enough of it, you start to know what you're looking at. And you know, you gotta open those eyes, young fella. You want to be on the field one day, you're not gonna get any better there. But if I could trade positions with him, I probably would too.
One first down coming in the near side, and the pass is complete to Shannon Lightfoot.
Lightfoot catches that one out of the off the arm of Andre Davis, who's throwing that out pattern pretty well so far here late in the second quarter. 23 seconds to go, and they'll move the chains on that one.
And you notice every time he's had success throwing that out pattern, it's when they've moved the pocket. So I don't. He's got enough arm strength to get the out pattern there, but I don't think he has the height. I mean, they list him at 6 feet. That's kind of generous. Every time he's thrown over somebody, so they have to move him to the right or left just to find a throwing lane for him.
Another completion for Davis. Gets down across the 40 to the 43-yard line. 12 yards on the play.
Now, this is something he's got to learn.
Again.
No point in calling a timeout. When you get a first down in college, the clock was already stopped. So when you get some experience, you know that you're just supposed to go ahead and let it ride out. You know, call your play. Call two plays in your mind that you know, and don't hold on to those timeouts. You may lead them later on during this drive.
All right, 15 seconds to go here in the first half. Tennessee State trying to get on the board. First and 10, 15 seconds. Clock certainly not the friend of the Tigers of Tennessee State right now as they're trying to get on the board and go into the halftime locker room. Coming off something positive, Davis going for it all. That was underthrown and deflected and intercepted. And again, it is Theron Thomas, his second pick of the game, but we have a flag down at the Tennessee State 40. So let's see how they sort this one out. Only 2 seconds left in the half. And a personal foul against James Webster's team, and that's a few too many, and we're only through a half of this ballgame.
Personal foul, number 67 with hands to the face. That penalty is declined. First and 10.
So with 2 seconds to go and a 16-point lead, I'd imagine that they take a knee.
You know, take a look there. Good job by the DB going for the ball to Ty's point. And you've got the free safety. Theron Thomas is being Johnny on the spot. He's played a good first half. His second interception in two possessions. Back-to-back interceptions for Thomas. And that's how you play free safety. You let nobody get further than you on the field.
And the quarterback, Watkins, going to take a knee. And at the end of the half, Tennessee State fans shot the ball. It is 16-0 in favor of the Aggies of North Carolina A&T. We'll get to set for all the halftime festivities and the Battle of Bands coming up. Today's Circle City Classic brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Over 2,800 nonstop daily flights to 60 destinations all across the country. And 16-0 at the half. North Carolina A&T leading Tennessee State, and a bit of a surprise right here, but we talked about it, Jay Walker, before the game, during the game, and right now up to half. Turnovers have killed the Tigers of Tennessee State all year long, and they're killing them again after a half a play in the Circle City Classic.
Yeah, I mean, you can't win a football game if you don't hold on to the football, because that means the other team is going to get it. And you see Ricky Lewis here on something simple like a handoff exchange. They can't execute that. Then you see Ricky Lewis doing a good job of making them pay for turning over the football. And you like when defensive players get the football and they become offensive on the return. So Ricky Lewis had a defensive lineman's dream with a 70-yard fumble recovery for a touchdown.
So A&T fans enjoying the festivities here after a half of the Circle City Classic. But earlier, everybody enjoyed the performance of Kirk Franklin, who entertained the crowd before kickoff earlier today.
That's old school. You don't remember nothing about that. When my enemies tried to come for me, and they fought.
Yeah.
ready for the Aristocrats of Band.
Get your Bowflex Selectech for just $5 a month today.
Okay, y'all. Get ready for the Aristocrats of Band, Tennessee State. They're about to do the thing. And don't forget to vote BET.com and see the Battle of the Bands. Who's going to do it? Get ready, Tennessee State, the Aristocrats of Band.
Thank you. /BCF and vote for your favorite band of the week after today's game, and we'll have the results of that poll for you next week from Columbus, Georgia. Meanwhile, halftime here in North Carolina, A&T in control over Tennessee State in the Circle City Classic. 16-0 at the break. Turnovers again, Jay Walker, the key in this one in the first half.
Yeah, whenever you're going to have great defenses, you're going to expect the offense to turn over the ball, and a good defense will force a turnover. You see here on the miscue on the handoff between the quarterback and the passing back, and then the quarterback came out here, and Davis couldn't find his rhythm, didn't know where the free safety was. Interception, not once, but you came the same read again. Davis drops back, similar type play, but this one's going to be tipped by two A&T defenders before the interception. Interception, but you expect to see turnovers when you got two great defenses on the field.
All right, today's halftime report and the stats brought to you by Southwest Airlines, over 2,800 nonstop flights to 16 destinations all across the country, and the numbers, while the total yards look about even, the turnovers is key here.
Turnovers is key, and also A&T had some more explosive plays than they did. They had the 70-yard fumble recovery, but they also had a big run by Spate for 55 yards as well, so A&T's been more explosive. Tennessee State's moved the ball, but they haven't managed to punch it in the end zone.
Tennessee State's going to need to do something here in the second half, trailing by 16 again. Today's halftime report brought to you by Southwest Airlines. We'll be back with the start of the third quarter here in the Circle City Classic in just a few moments.
About to start the third quarter here in Indianapolis, Indiana. And stay tuned following the game for the blockbuster movie, Belly, starring rappers Nas and DMX, who experience spiritual awakenings as Manhattan gangsters. Catch Belly tonight at 11 p.m. Eastern, right here on BET. Right now, 16-0, favor of the Aggies of North Carolina A&T starting the third quarter. Tennessee State will be kicking the Aggies the ball this time around. Kick is high and deep to the near side, and Juwan McBride takes it inside his five, and looked as if one official was almost signaling it was a touchback, but I guess not. He's going to come out of bounds at about the 20-yard line, does Juwan McBride, so about 18 yards on the return there.
That was a great kick. I mean,
yeah.
In the college game, it gets overlooked a lot of times, but that kick pinned him deep in his corner, so he had no choice. He had to run it out because the momentum took him there. And when you can kick the ball to that pylon there, you narrow down the field and limit the opportunity for a good return.
Rico Watkins, 4 of 5, 23 yards, has kept the ball on the ground. Done some damage with his legs as well. And no turnover.
Yeah, you know,
quarterback spot.
You know me, I'm a quarterback.
Okay.
I'm dying up.
All right.
Very efficient. 4 of 5 for 23 yards. Now, if you're going to go 4 or 5, you need to have about 160 yards passing in one half. 4 or 5 for 23 yards. Come on, baby. What happened to the vertical passing game? This is too much horizontal going on in college football nowadays.
And see how aggressive Coach Small stays with a 16-point lead starting the third quarter, and we immediately have a flag before we get our first playoff.
Ball start. Number 62, the offense, penalized 5 yards. Still first down.
Not a way you want to begin the half, Christopher Gates.
I mean, Chris, I hyped you up. I said the NFL's watching. You got your folks watching back in D.C. You come out, start off the first half with a penalty. Get it together, son. Let's go. Come on, Aggie Pride. Let's get it going.
First and 15 after the false start penalty on Gates. Rico Watkins will give it. And changing direction immediately, creating some room for himself, is Quante Spate. And Spate gets those 5 yards back. So it'll be 2nd and 10 after the 5-yard run. Spate approaching that 100-yard mark already. And again, after going so long without a 100-yard runner, it seems to be a common thread for this A&T offense, producing 100-yard backs out of the backfield.
Yeah, Spate's doing a good job of staying on the field. You know, they realize that A&T is just so thin at the running back position right now. Backing him up are two walk-on freshmen, so Spate realizes the importance of this game to help his team get this victory, and he's doing a good job running the football.
Ball up the middle, across the 30 to the 37-yard line, and he's still fighting for yardage. He is stacked up right there. A gain of 17 for Spate, which puts him well over 100 yards in the game.
You know, just like with quarterbacks, though, getting completions is contagious. Running the football is contagious. Offensive line, look at these guys up front. They get hyped up when you get positive yardage plays. They tell the coach, run it again, run it again. Zone blocking scheme, body on the body, creating the alley for Spate to run through. Good job of recognizing the alley and getting up their field. But offensive line, I've never seen. They'll sit there and tell me as a
quarterback, I'll call another run play. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. I'm going to pass.
Spade getting out close to the 40 before a host of blue jerseys bring him down. One of them, 96, Ernest Jones on the defense. Also helping out Almonte Duncan on the tackle.
You know, great coaches always say, you know, some of the most important possessions of a football game are the ones that start off the game and the ones coming out of the half. Right now, if you're Tennessee State, this defense is your strength. They got to make a stop. Because if A&T puts any points on the board, it becomes desperation time for the Tigers. So the Tennessee State defense has to focus right now and make a stop.
Spade on the draw and hit in the backfield. And four blue jerseys are back there, the first of which was Carl Buford, the linebacker, also helped out by Miguel Hill and a couple of others. Aaron Strong also back in the backfield on the tackle.
Somebody's listening to what I'm talking about. You know, but good job by Almonte Duncan beating the one-on-one. And, you know, one of the things we haven't done is this is a time where your stars got to make some plays. You know, Wesley Holmes and Jamar Landon, this is where you come up with the big play there. Now, it'll be interesting to see third and long. We know that Coach Small so far in the first half was very conservative in his play calling on third down. And he's coming out in a conservative look right now with two backs in the backfield.
Two receivers split to the far side. And Watkins rolling out, throwing. And that one right off the number of his receiver on the far side. We also have a flag on the play. It was Brown, Douglas Brown, on the far side, and that one just hit right off his chest.
He threw it in a bad spot, right? The flag.
Yeah. And it looks like the preliminary indication is that it will be against A&T, and Coach Webster, you see, saying will decline. So after moving the chain a couple times.
Number 24, the offense, the penalty is declined.
Michael Christen on the holding penalty, so they'll decline it. And the incomplete pass creates fourth down. And Dominique Brown will punt, averaging 43.8 yards a kick coming into this game. And he'll punt it deep to Gerald Morrow, who's standing back at his own 21. Line drive kick. But Morrow is not able to field it. And it's going to roll dead at the 22-yard line. Give him 39 yards on the punt and no return. 12-17 to go in the third. A&T holding that 16-point lead.
To a sexy stomach, just send it back for a refund of your $14.95.
And a beautiful, beautiful afternoon here in Indianapolis, Indiana. Third quarter, and A&T leading 16-0. And there's your starter, Andre Davis of Tennessee State, on the bench right now because he's been replaced by Richard Hartman at quarterback. And the pitch going early, and that is Javaris Williams. Williams trying to win a foot race and gets dragged down at the 33-yard line. We do have a flag on the play, however. 48 yards on the run. And everybody trying to figure who committed an infraction.
It happened downfield, whatever the call may be, but it was a good run by Williams exploding through the hole. The flag that might have been an illegal block downfield.
First down, sideline warning. Sideline warning on Tennessee State. That's their first warning. First and 10.
I can live with that. That's what Coach Webster said. Okay, I can live with that. And everybody move back.
Richard Hartman, a 6'1", 215-pound junior, in at the quarterback spot. Four interceptions and two touchdowns on the year. And being brought in to try to lead a comeback. Javaris Williams, big hole off the right side. Williams, first down yardage. And a little bit more down to the 21-yard line. Fresh quarterback. Fresh enthusiasm, and Tennessee State, after the 11-yard gain, moving it impressively up the field.
Harper coming in and giving them a spark. It hasn't been with his arm thus far. It's been with his handoff and his play selection, but they're doing a good job, and, you know, good job by Coach Webster and the staff getting Tennessee State to come out offensively and make a stand. They did not represent themselves well in the first half, but they got the running game going right now. This is the Tennessee State football team that we thought we would see.
Javaris Williams now with 80 yards in the game. On the ground, and we get some movement first by the defense. LaShawn McClain, big nose tackle, moved first, and then Damian Pitts, the left guard, moved in response. Let's see who will get the 5-yard penalty.
I think it was Pitts in there, you know. How crucial can that be right there? I mean, you come out, you got momentum, you're running the ball, getting first down, and then you come out and make it first and 15, basically assuring yourself you're going to throw the ball on one of these next three downs.
Offside. Defense.
Oh.
Number 98. Penalized 5 yards.
Video game action going on during our football game here, and he sees himself on television. So the infraction against the defense of A&T, 5-yard penalty. That's the Aggies' fourth penalty. This is the deepest Tennessee State penetration of the game, inside the 20 to the 17-yard line of A&T. And we get more movement inside. So for the second play in a row, and it looked like again, A&T moves first. LaShawn McClain inside from the nose tackle position.
I mean, it's funny what's going on, because I think on that last play, Coach Webster got so upset at Damian Pitts, he decided to replace him for a play.
All start. Number 77 offense, penalized 5 yards, still first down.
So he wanted to replace him for a play, and the guy he brings in to replace him for the play jumps offside. So what does he do? Hey, get back in there, Damian. I'm sorry. It wasn't your fault. But now you got Pitts in there at the left guard position again. And he told the coach all along. He wasn't in.
First and 10. And the handoff, not much yardage, maybe two on the run play off the near side. And again, that's Javaris Williams. And it'll be second down and called about 8. Maybe 9 on the play, or 9 to go for first down yardage.
And this is the benefit of having a quarterback that can beat you with his arms. See, A&T would love to sit up there and line up and know some type of rollout was coming. When you got Hartman in there, pocket passer, you got to cover the whole field, not just one side of it.
Two receivers split to either side. Hartman from the shotgun. Blitz is on, and he got rid of it. He was looking for his wide receiver, Shannon Lightfoot, who was being guarded closely by Theron Thomas.
You know, the difference on any level, college, especially professional, in a great quarterback and a good quarterback, the great quarterbacks get excited when the blitz is coming their way. They know it's man-to-man coverage. The good to suspect quarterbacks, well, they get blitzed and they get a little timid. You got to learn how to attack a blitz if you want to be a great quarterback. So all you young quarterbacks out there, feel comfortable with the blitz, because you got to realize when you get blitzed, you get an opportunity for a big play.
And Art Cox down the game in motion to the top of your screen, the far side, empty backfield. Blitz is on. Morrow on the little hitter at the wide receiver spot, and he picks up some blocks but does not get enough for the first down. He'll be brought down about 2 yards short at the 14-yard line.
I like the way Morrow did with this ball. You know, the play got, the timing of it got disrupted. You like him to catch that ball a little bit closer to the middle of the field, but he just caught that ball and just started moving forward right away. Didn't have time to dance around and go sideways. He just went straight forward and almost picked up the first down.
And Eric Benson, who has not attempted a field goal yet this year, will attempt this one from 30 yards. Tennessee State on the board. And he does. Inside the left upright, Eric Benson. 1-for-1 field goals for his career and this season. And Tennessee State on the board with 9:48 to go in the third.
New from Regenerist.
9:48 to go in the third quarter. A&T's lead trimmed to 13 because of the Tennessee State field goal by Eric Benson. His first career field goal capped a six-play, 65-yard drive. 2.5 minutes of possession. 30-yard field goal. And battle of the bands. We saw two good ones go at it at halftime. The Aristocrat of Bands, Tennessee State, against the Blue and Gold Marching Machine. You can log on at BET.com/BCF after the game and vote for your winner. We'll have the results for you next week. Everybody's eyes glued to both bands at halftime here at the Circle City Classic. Michael Strife will be kicking on the near side. Deep will be Jawan McBride. And on the far side, looks like it's Brandon Trusty who's taking up kickoff return duties for this this game today, and they're going to take a high short one. Krusty on the far side of his 20 gets the corner and making some nifty moves over there, and he gets down to about the 33-yard line. Actually, it was not Krusty. It was Chaz Dawson on the far side of the field who got the return.
Freshman wide receiver who they're very excited about down in North Carolina A&T, Chaz Dawson.
And we have a flag down on the play as well.
Offside. Number 33 of the kicking team. The penalty is enforced from the end of the run. First and 10.
So another penalty against Tennessee State. So it'll be first down and better field position for the Aggies of North Carolina A&T. They'll get it at their own 38-yard line. Coach Webster questioning who was offside and why did you call it. Now the defense has to come up with another stop here and get Hartman and the offense the ball back. Trying to get back in this one. Roll out. Watkins got to keep it. All the way, and Watkins across the 40 out to the 43-yard line.
Sticking with the play action with a conservative play calling. I like the call. You give him the fake the run to the right side. You got a left-handed quarterback. Just give him a simple read. Hey, you either got one guy that's open in front of you or you tuck the ball and run it. That's what we mean by conservative play calling. Don't ask your quarterback to read the whole field. Just give him simple, call him run pass option. You're either going to run the ball or you're going to do a quick little pass. Not a throw, a pass.
They can't stop Wally either.
Tennessee State trying to keep that momentum offensively. You see one of the coaches talking to that unit on the sidelines, hoping for the defense to do something. Quante Spade stood up and driven backwards. And a big hit being delivered in the backfield. That was Leonard Davis.
Take a look at Francis DeLore here. This is how you force the run. He's got outside contain. He just shoots up this way to allow the A&T running back to have to go back in the middle. See, that's how you play team football, by Francis DeLore not allowing the offensive lineman to turn him inside out. He took away the outside shoulder and made the running play go back inside. Leonard Davis was the beneficiary of the great pass of the rush by Francis DeLore.
Davis, Dorleen, right there. 6'3", 290-pound senior is Leonard Davis. And on the blitz, Watkins stepping up in the pocket and just throws that one away as his intended receiver was well blanketed by Aaron Strong.
And if you're Coach Small, you got to be very disappointed. Your team has come out here flat. And if you don't get your act together, before you know it, this could be a six-point ball game if Tennessee State can manage to punch the ball in the end zone. A&T, that's why when you get an opportunity out there, you got to close your opponent every chance you get. Because the longer you let them stay around, they get an opportunity to stay in the football game.
In the first possession, they were establishing some very good things with Spate, and here's an unusual formation. Now they're going to shift into punt protect, trying to create some confusion on the punt block team. It looks like most guys are on the line of scrimmage. You got eight. And a nice booming kick. Morrow will field it at his 11.
A reverse.
Seven-yard punt and a 26-yard return. And that one by Dominique Rogers. And a little trickery, gaining some extra yards for the Tigers of Tennessee State University. Dominique Brown, a booming kick. And while everybody focused on little number 81, big number 45 takes the reverse for positive yardage.
Good job on the special teams unit there. A little creativity trying to help jumpstart this offense.
Richard Hartman, high formation behind him. And off the play fake, Hartman coming deep near side, has Burnett. And Burnett taken down immediately at the 49-yard line. A pickup of 12, move the chains. First down, and I sense a momentum shift here a little bit. Tennessee State looking sharp here in the second half.
And that was a big-time throw by Richard Hartman. To have the arm strength to throw the ball from one hash mark to the deep out route on the other side there. That's how you measure arm strength. So that's the frustrating thing. You know he's got the arm strength. He can make all the throws. The key is that he's always going to go to the right person with the football. But that was a big-time throw by Richard Hartman.
Burnett, their leading receiver coming into the game. 6'1", 185 senior. Now, Cade J. Austin Bruce doesn't get anything. In fact, he loses as he's met immediately in the backfield by one of those active linebackers helping out Shamar Milton, one of the Dudley trio, as they like to call him, their leading tackler coming in here.
And that's how you make a tackle. I mean, the key is, you know, football, you got collisions on every play. But the key is, after you tackle, you want to land on the running back, and that's where the pain is. You take a look at the Dudley trio, the pride of Greensboro, North Carolina.
Yeah, Lewis, we've already seen him outrun the offense on that 70-yard fumble return.
We've seen Thomas with two interceptions.
Right, Thomas, two interceptions.
We just saw Shamar Milton right there just with a punishing blow.
Without hesitation, Coach Small said they were the best athletes on his team and the leaders on this team. All three defenders, same high school. Hartner pulls it down, going to keep it. And trying to get to the far side, crosses midfield to the 49. So that'll set up a third down and long situation for Tennessee State.
And that's one there that, you know, when you got the quarterback in the threat, you don't blitz him as much because he can hurt you a little bit more with the pass. So they play a great zone coverage there, and Hartman doesn't have the mobility that Davis has. That's why teams are always going back and forth in terms of what they're going to try and accomplish on the defensive side of the ball. Defense versus offense, offense versus defense.
Third down. And call it eight. Hartman out of the shotgun with two receivers, split to either side. Blitz is on. Steps up, looking for it, Auburn. That was wide open, and he overthrew.
Wow. Boom. Everything but the touchdown pass. I mean, he did a good job of standing in the pocket in the face of the blitz and just missed by about 2 yards for the wide open touchdown, had they been able to convert on the completion. Watch him stand in the pocket. The blitz is coming. He doesn't get nervous. He doesn't get scared. Doesn't get rattled. Just stays there, trusts his offensive lineman. He just missed on the post route.
No, that's one they wish they could have back, so it'll create a fourth down punting situation. Micah Strife will strike this one from his 40. High kick. It's going to bounce inside the 20-yard line and roll out of bounds at the 17 or 18. So, North Carolina A&T still with that 13-point lead, 5:42 to go in the third of the Circle City Classic.
Yes, you can.
A&T leading Tennessee State in the Circle City Classic 16-3, 5:42 to go in the third quarter. Let's join Joe Torre, who moments ago caught up with a very special guest, U.S. Olympian Dominique Dawes. Joe?
Hey, what's up, y'all? I'm here with Dominique Dawes, the beautiful, the lovely Dominique Dawes. You were awarded earlier the Major Taylor Award, and is this your first Black Classic football game?
This is definitely my first Black Classic football game, and it won't be my last, and I was definitely honored to receive the Major Taylor Award, just having an opportunity to do some research on the obstacles that he was able to overcome, and the fact that I'm being honored with this award, it's truly humbling.
What's exciting about being here?
It's truly just a feel of enthusiasm. Everyone's very passionate. Everyone wants to be here, and it just feels good to be around family.
Oh, yeah? Now, does it, all this excitement, these people make you feel like just, I don't know, you're very, very good competitor, but does it make you want to turn a backflip or do something?
Not really. I can still do a few backflips, though. Wouldn't be close to a 10-0 anymore, but it just makes me want to come to more events like this more often, maybe going to, something in the D.C. area.
Very beautiful. Bye, Eric and Jay. I'm standing here with Dominique Dawes, and I am in heaven. BT Black Classic Football is stepping.
Joe picking all the good-looking ones today on the field.
Man, I mean, what a 10. I mean, 10.0 routine.
If you're hungry, man, just take a look.
He's got
the nachos dressed up.
That's another of these classics, man. There's food all over the place. You know, outside you got fried fish, fried chicken, fried everything. And the inside you got even more stuff. So
Watkins on the pump fake, keeps it. And okay, you talk about the nachos and the hunger. You know what? I got a little something for you because big fella can put his heat on, and they went out to Soul Food yesterday. Check him out. He's doing the greens there.
Man, I told the missus that I was eating salads yesterday.
Uh-oh, you're busted now.
Oh, man, y'all set me up there.
Look at him peeping around.
Right there. Look at that championship ring from Howard University.
Oh, God. He would have to mention that.
Hey, if you're going to get caught, you might as well get caught wearing the bling bling.
No, man, unfortunately, I missed that one because I had eaten a little bit earlier, and everybody's telling me I should have joined you so they'd have both of us on camera.
Boy, I'm going to get Joe Torre and John. Boy. They set me up, yeah.
On the draw, bait is met immediately, and the Tennessee State defense, led by Carl Buford, the inside linebacker on that play, is coming up big. And for the third consecutive possession, A&T will have to punt the ball away back to Tennessee State. So definitely some adjustments have been made defensively by the Tigers.
Oh, yeah, and right now they're saying three and out. You know, defense is loving three and out. Three plays, get off the field, bring the offense back. But the key is you got to have more than 3 points to show for three consecutive three and outs.
And this is a game breaker back deep. This is Dominique Brown, the punter.
He's a little thick punter.
Yeah, he can boom them too, averaging over 43 yards a kick. And there's another one. But Morrow might have a chance to return this one from his 35. Morrow stopped in his tracks as he crosses midfield. 43-yard punt and a 16-yard return by Gerald Morrow.
What a tough guy there. I mean, he got one of those hits where everybody in the stadium said, ooh, and he got up like it was nothing. You know, when you're that small, you used to get hit by big people all your life.
Today's trivia answer is brought to you by Jeep. Trail-rated capability only in a Jeep 4x4. The question is, name the only person in the MEAC to win a conference championship as both a player and a coach, and you're looking at it. The answer is George Small. Played for A&T in 1975 as a player and won the title as a coach a couple years ago back in 2003, as we talked about in the open, raising those expectations for the Aggie faithful. Hartman setting up screen near side. Burnett waiting for his blockers and gets down inside the 45 to the 43.
Simple little pass play there, but everybody tries to run these little screens on the outside, but what you got to have is a guy that has the time and knows how to do it. And what Burnett did that time there was he caught the ball, the offensive line was coming to him, he managed to shake and bait to create the hole there and wait for them to turn the play that should have got no yardage into a 5-yard gain.
On second and five, Richard Hartman and company trying to continue that spark to the Tiger offense. And the pitch going to Javaris Williams. Williams trying to get the corner, does not. Might have lost a yard on the play. Aggie defense really active that time. One of the guys in there was Larry Harrison. Bringing down Williams for maybe a loss of a yard. So it'll be third and six.
What is an Aggie?
An agricultural person?
You know, that was one thing, you know, when he's talking about what's an Aggie, you know, we used to always say Aggie, that dog that just chases you out the neighborhood when you shouldn't be there. You know, they protect their house. That's what an Aggie is.
Two receivers split near side. Hartman goes to the near side and threw it a little bit behind his intended target, Chris Johnson, who tried to come up with it. And this is the kind of territory, again, down 13, getting late in the third quarter. Do you go for it here on fourth and six, or do you punt it away and pin them back with the way your defense has been playing?
I mean, defense has been playing great three and out, so I think if the defense continues to play they are, their next step is going to be to try and force some type of turnover. So keep your defense on the field as often as you can in good situations and try and help them force a turnover, and you may become more aggressive on the defensive side, meaning, you know, go for some more blitzes to try and cause have to disrupt the time a little bit more rather than try and force anything with the offense that just hasn't been able to get it done today.
Brandon Trusty back deep to receive his punt, standing at his own 10, and a high one by Strife. He'll bounce right at the goal line and into the end zone for a touchback. 45-yard punt, no return on the touchback, so it'll come out to the 20-yard line where A&T will take over. Today's game summary is brought to you by the United States Air Force. Cross into the blue. Lewis, the 70-yard fumble return for a touchdown, and the turnover story is big. Tennessee State with three.
Well, at least that number hasn't gone up.
Right.
I mean, that's the key. The number has not gone up. It stayed down. So if they can keep that, they get the chance to get back in this football game.
A&T has to make some adjustments offensively and at least sustain a drive here. Take some time off the clock. Watkins off the play fake. Step it up. Now in trouble. Down he goes.
You know, they almost got what they wanted. You know, they wanted the defense on the field to try and disrupt the time and to force turnovers. Enrico almost gave it to him. You know, we talked about it from the beginning. This is a guy that's got a problem holding the ball a little bit too far away from his body. And he was lucky that Duncan didn't strip him there because he bobbled that ball while he was being sacked.
Almonte Duncan came into the game with a sack so far this season. 22 total tackles, third on the team. 4D tackle, if not too bad. And Duncan,
I mean, if you got a D-tackle that high up there, he can play.
Yeah.
D-tackles, you know, defensive coordinators love when D-tackles are making tackles. That means they're very effective and they're stopping the run. So Amunchie Duncan being third on team tackles means he's a great football player.
That was a busted play as Watkins was looking to hand it off on the draw play. And nobody was back there, so that'll be another sack. And Tennessee State is really controlling everything defensively after one first down gotten by A&T on their initial drive of the third quarter. State has really controlled this thing at the line of scrimmage.
Well, let's be fair to the Tiger defense. I mean, they played a good first half. I mean, you know, A&T had one big run that set up one. They had two mishaps basically on defense, but other than that, they played a pretty good first half. It's not like A&T drove the ball up and down the field on them. You know, the offense gave A&T 7 of their 16 points.
And this is just what a defense wants. You want to force Rico Watkins to have to throw the football, and he does here late in the third quarter. Third and long.
I knew there was no way Coach Ma was going to throw the football. Quarterback draw was coming all the way. You know that. If he won't throw the ball on 3rd and 6, there's no way he thinks he's going to throw it on 3rd and 18.
Jeffrey Osborne once had a song that seems like what A&T is doing now. Holding on.
Holding on. Let that clock tick and try taking it to the fourth quarter.
Down inside the final 10 seconds here in the third. Don't know if they'll get this punt off before the end of the third. Of course, not a win situation inside the beautiful RCA Dome, and that'll be it. Fourth quarter has expired, so we will have the punt of Dominique Brown punting to Gerald Morrow when we start the fourth quarter. A&T is leading Tennessee State 16-3, 15 minutes of football to go.
This portion of the Circle City Classic has been brought to you by Jeep. Trail-rated capability, only in a Jeep 4x4.
Next stop is Clark Atlanta University.
Welcome back to Naptown, Circle City Classic, y'all. I'm standing here with Justin and Nikki. Ford Roadies, they're on the road every weekend going around the HBCUs. That's extraordinary black colleges, in case you don't know that. And your mission is to do what?
We are here to promote the HBCU experience and basically the best in black college football.
Okay, okay. Now, you said something earlier about promoting education to high school, making the high schoolers, making them, you know, known and aware about going to college.
Yeah, basically what we do in each market, you know, we promote higher education in middle schools. We also give away $1,000 worth of school supplies to encourage them, you know what I'm saying, that education is the key, and preferably go to a black college, you know what I'm saying, if you are a minority.
That is so good, y'all. Justin, Nikki, hey, Eric and Jay is going on down here. Ford Road is they doing it for education. HBCUs, come on now. All right? That's what we're talking about. See y'all later. I got to find some more people.
That front is downed inside the 50 at the 48-yard line. We had you eating there. I think he's got you beat, though, Jay.
Yeah, y'all
just destroyed that hot dog.
You guys are exposing folks' diet today. You know, feeding him the chips and stuff. Well, he looks like he's tired eating. He's like, you know, Mom, I'm kind of cool on the food right now, but you know what your mama said? Come on, baby, you got to finish it all up.
Today's end of quarter stats. These are third quarter stats only, brought to you by McDonald's. I'm loving it. And in the third quarter, Tennessee State controlling things, allowing A&T 0 passing yards.
Yeah, they kind of woke up offensively. They had good balance there, running and throwing the football. Unfortunate thing, only 3 points. They need a little bit more than that.
And Hartman on the out pattern. And that was timed well. Again, Fred Burnett coming out of his break, and the ball was right there for him just the way you draw it up.
The textbook right there. They're having some success doing the out routes. And in the college game today, I mean, a lot of defenses will give you the out route. They think if you've got a quarterback that can throw it, we'll give it to you. So what you have to do is when they're going to give it to you, take what the defense is giving you. You hear that in all levels of football. Take what the defense is giving you. They're giving them the out route. Hartman's been able to exploit it.
First down yardage to Burnett off that hookup. And we had a little movement. You might have seen some at the top of your screen. And a tight end in the game moving a little bit.
Offense. Penalized 5 yards. Still first down.
Tyler Martin is upset with himself. Backup tight end. Moving a little bit early. Cost them 5, so 1st and 15.
Now get excited. You're hard, you get excited. That means you're going to get some throws during this series. You know your coach wants to run the ball.
Spoken like a true quarterback.
Quarterback, hey, first 15, we got to throw it, coach, if you want to get it.
Two receivers split to either side of Hartman. Dropping straight back in the pocket. Going for it all.
Look out.
And he's picked.
Made up his mind before he threw the ball.
Jawan McBride on the interception. The third of the game for the A&T defense. And another turnover for Coach Webster and his Tennessee State Tigers.
You know, we know Hartman has the arm, but his problem has been interception. On this case here, watch this. He's going to go for the pump fake. That pump is to bring the safety up. The safety that move, he just keeps dropping back. Now watch two A&T defenders over there to go for this interception then. One versus two. I like my chances if I'm on defense. He made up his mind before the ball was snapped where he was going to go with the football, and you just can't do that in the game of football. If it's a three-step drop, sure, you have to use your pre-snap read, but not on a five-step drop.
Fourth turnover of the day for the Tigers. And the Aggies of A&T get it back, first and 10 from their own 12. And there's Quante Spate getting 8 yards or more out to the 20-yard line. Actually, that might not have been Spate. Michael Ferguson, the true freshman, coming in, number 28, 5'10", 190 pounds, picks up 7 yards on that play. It'll be second and 3. Today's Circle City Classic is brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Over 2,800 nonstop daily flights to 60 destinations all across the country. Coach talked about him this week. Do you think he has a lot of potential, Michael Ferguson? Going to give Quante Spate a little breathing room. And here's Ferguson again on second down. And he gets close to the sticks, which are at the 23-yard line. See where they spot it. Of course, they're just trying to eat up clock, keep the ball on the ground. We're going to be inside 13 minutes to go when they run their next play.
You take a look at Wesley Holmes there, the inside linebacker. I mean, this is a guy that last year had to sit out the whole season for Tennessee State. So they kind of had a hunch that their defense might improve a lot with his return, but did they think their defense would be this good right now? The Tennessee State defense is putting on a dominating performance in the second half.
They're down very short. I don't know if you take it out of your big quarterback's hands, and boy, we get a lot of movement on the right side. Jarrett Martin, big number 72, 6'4", 300-pound senior. Miscalculated on the snap count there, so now it'll be third and longer.
How much did you say Marlon Wayne?
Well,
man.
Well, I see what he's listed at. I think he does. Wait a minute, that might have been a misread by me.
Offense number 71. Still third down.
I mean, I've rarely seen 370 pounds on a football field. I'm looking at 3-7. I'm not even looking at media guy. He was the one guy that when I was talking to Coach Small in the pregame, you know, who stood out, like, wow, how big is that guy, Coach? You know, there's only about
right.
two or three on the football team.
Right.
It was the only one. Normally three or four. How big is that guy, Marlon? He said, you know what, Jay, the thing is, we got him down 30 pounds.
Wow.
I said, wow.
Christian Hill comes in to replace him. If they're mistaken, the play clock is going to go to zero. And Watkins, even if it didn't go to zero, is sacked. He's brought down from behind by Holmes, the middle linebacker, coming on a blitz. I guess there was no flag. So another sack, and Tennessee State recovers from the turnover and keeps A&T pinched deep into its own territory. So they should get good field position after this punt. We know Dominique Brown can boom them, but he's punting to the ever-dangerous Gerald Morrow, who's standing back at his own 45. High kick will come down to Morrow, who fielded at his 39. Morrow gets it out across the 45 to the 47-yard line. Tennessee State taking over after the 50-yard punt and the 7-yard return. It's our final game of the season here on BET, and it couldn't be a better one. The Tuskegee Morehouse Classic from Columbus, Georgia. Broadcast time here on BET is 7:30 p.m. next Saturday night. John David Washington, the Morehouse star and the son of the great actor Denzel Washington, leading the Morehouse attack.
You know, in the thing about this, it's a family event out here, definitely. But think about that matchup we got next week. we're going to see J.D. Washington going against Tuskegee, and Tuskegee is loaded this year.
And there's Richard Hartman, who got bogged down in the backfield. He'll be a little short of the line of scrimmage. And that was LaShawn McClain, one of the guys who brought him down. We call that a sack.
Yeah, you know, we talk about Tuskegee being loaded. You know, let you know, I know something what I'm talking about. They're sitting there at 4-0, number three, and that's a Division II team that's ranked ahead of all these 1AA teams between Tuskegee and North Carolina Central. So, you know, if you're J.D. Washington and you're a star, you want to play against the best. And he's going to play against the best team in Division II football right now.
Whoa. The blitz was coming, and they'll get an excessive celebration penalty against Shamar Milton, who delayed the blitz and just leveled Hartman.
It was a great tackle, but you just negated this great play because they're going to get a first down out of this. But watch Milton. One thing I talk about Milton, he knows how to tackle folks. See, the collision is one thing, but you see how he lands on him? That's what hurts. I mean, you know, that's when you separate shoulders and you wake up with that stiff shoulder when you got those big 240-pound linebackers landing on you like that.
And he's wondering, what, me?
Well, you know, they caught him. He was taunting. I mean, he did a celebration after that there. So I'm saying by it was a great sack, but with the unsportsmanlike conduct, you know, that's automatic first down. So you just negated your great play. It was all for nothing on the stat sheet. Take a look at Andre Davis there. I mean, he's a youngster. His better days are ahead of him. It's a learning experience. You know, he's still a little wide-eyed in terms of what happened.
Yeah.
I alluded to that earlier.
There are two fouls. Illegal substitution on the defense. That's a 5-yard penalty. At the end of the play, there's a dead ball. Unsportsmanlike conduct foul for celebration. Number 43 of the defense.
We know a lot's been going on down there in the South, especially in the state of Texas, right? Well, the city of Houston finally has some good news. Texas Southern, Coach Steve Wilson and the Tigers go down to Alabama A&M on A&M's homecoming and walk away with the victory. 17-7. Congratulations to Coach Wilson, my old coach at Howard University, and his staff. They went 0-11 last year, but this year they've been competitive and they got their first victory. Hats off to the Texas Southern football team.
And it goes. Three receivers split out to the top, and Hartman will operate out of the shotgun with Javaris Williams in motion to the near side. So empty backfield now. First and 10 after that crucial penalty on the celebration. Here comes another blitz, and he gets rid of it quickly. And Burnett shook a tackle, had some room, and Burnett picked up eight, close to 9 yards on the little wide receiver screen.
You know, Burnett does a good job on that timing on that one. You see Deron Thomas going off the field there. He looks a little dinged up. But Burnett, you know, we talked about earlier, he's got the patience on knowing where his blockers are coming from. You know, you're out there on the wide receiver screen. They tell you don't run to the sideline because you don't have any blockers coming your way. Cut back in the middle of the field. He's got the patience. He does a good job on running that wide receiver screen.
Brent Burnett has been busy today. 5 catches. And this will be second down and short. A lot of offenses like to call this free play.
Except when you got a quarterback out there that's known for throwing interceptions, bingos, Oscars, Christmas, Santa Claus, whatever you want to call interception, your neck of the woods.
Nifty backfield, Hartman rolling near side, throwing end zone, short! And you went to the Howard University, but did you major in, like, psychic ability?
Oh, man, I mean, you can't do that. You just can't do it. When you're down there that close, free play, you say it's either going to be a touchdown rush or throw the ball out of bounds. I mean, what are you thinking about? That right there will be a reason why if Hartman doesn't see the field the rest of the year, it'll be plays like that. I mean, you can't do this. He's got no rush. He gets a great seal block by the tight end there, Woods, and he's out there in the pocket. He's making this throw, and he underthrows the wide receiver. I mean, you know, there was no way. The guy was covered. You know, you just wonder, what are you looking at?
Wilbert Johnson looked like through the interception. And Coach Webster earlier talked to us about the only thing that would damage his team would be turnovers where they beat themselves.
Turnovers have hurt us. There is no doubt, you know. And no one can play perfect. But you take away the turnovers and we're easily 3-1. But once again, I'm not going to make any excuses for that. That's part of the game. Other teams turn the ball over. It so happens that right now we'll turn the ball over more than our fair share of it.
And more than your fair share. How about five for the game? Four interceptions, two for each quarterback, and that costly fumble, which was returned by Lewis, 70 yards for a touchdown.
Do you hear 116 calling? You know what the number 116 is?
that's a
good possibility of their ranking and turnover margin at the end of Saturday's competition.
A&T, if they ever needed to get some first downs on this drive, this was a time. They've had five possessions and absolutely nothing. Five punts here in the second half.
Well, but I'm going to give you a good thing about that interception, all right? This is something one of my coaches told me. It's better than a punt. I mean, you know, if you'd have punted the ball and it would have went to the end zone, you'd have got on the 20. Now you got an opportunity to start them on the 3-yard line. If your defense can make some plays happen, then, hey, you know, wind up. But the defense right now can't give up the big play. Hey, keep throwing the ball. You got to keep throwing the ball. Defense come up with a stop. And you got right now, you got to think, you got to go hurry up offense. And I got to get my offense on the field as many times as possible.
So this is third down and 7. And A&T has not been effective in obvious passing situations here in the second half. And the handoff. And that's a big, big first down. And the freshman running back, Michael Ferguson, bounces off tackles and picks up 15 yards. And he did that mostly on his own.
Yeah, that might have been the biggest run of this game thus far, you know, for the remainder of it. Because right now you're going to get more time. It's going to come off that clock. You get out of being backed up. And that's just one of those things that's inexcusable for defense that's played as great as they have this second half to give up that crucial 3rd and 7, you know, with the run there. But it was a great piece of running by Michael Ferguson. We don't want to take anything away from him for a freshman. You know, it's rare you see a freshman running hard like that.
Big tackle John Cato is getting help with his shoe, and the play clock down to 14. So they better call something really quickly.
Well, they should reset it. I mean, the official should have seen that there. Normally, you get a courtesy from the official doing something, but they just kind of turned away from him.
And that's what Coach Small is talking about. Hey, a guy lost some equipment. Give him a chance to replace it, and don't start penalizing us with the clock. But meanwhile, they take a timeout. 8:08 to go. A&T with a 13-point lead.
It's beautiful.
Stay tuned following the game for the blockbuster movie Belly, starring rappers Nas and DMX, who experience spiritual awakenings as Manhattan gangsters. Catch Belly tonight at 11 p.m. Eastern right here on BET. So third down, A&T started 3 of 4, has been 0 of 9 since. And this is Ferguson. And Ferguson on first down gets it. And the winner gets this Circle City Classic trophy. Right now, A&T nursing the 13-point lead with under 8 minutes to play.
Well, interesting fact that A&T is 19-8 in classic competition. That's a phenomenal record. Record would be a lot better if they stopped playing South Carolina State every year. South Carolina State has given them 5 of those defeats. And we're talking about South Carolina State, A&T's natural rival, the Border War they have every year. You know, take a look at a lot. I'm gonna tell you what I'm hearing out there. The team to beat, without a doubt, is supposed to be Grambling. Now that's swag football down there. That showdown is heading up there at Hampton Homecoming. It's Hampton versus South Carolina State. South Carolina State took on Coastal Carolina today, 1-point loss, so they'll go to 3-1. But Coastal Carolina's ranked in the top 5 in the country. And then Southern is struggling this year. I don't know if they'll maintain it. Albany State there, Bethune-Cookman. So it's an interesting year shaping up in black college football. But the class of the league so far, Hampton and South Carolina State.
And Watkins coming out of the play fake, and we get a penalty. And I tell you what, he doesn't agree with the call. This Jonathan Edwards, maybe a little face mask grab. And that's exactly what we have against Tennessee State. So that'll give A&T another first down.
Now before we check look at the replay, this face mask or shoulder? So I say Watkins, one of those guys, kind of lean. If you grab by the shoulder, it's going to look like his neck is coming back. Yeah, he's on the shoulder.
Wow.
He's on the shoulder, but his neck got snapped back. See, when you get those lean-type quarterbacks, that snap back of the neck kind of made it look like a face mask. But I thought it was a shoulder tackle all the way.
Well, it seemed awfully apparent there. I mean, from what we saw there on the replay, that he did grab just inside the shoulder pad there and yanked it backwards. So a tough break on that call. The official called what he thought he saw. He's supposed to protect players, especially if he thinks they're grabbed by the face mask. 76 yards in penalties against the Tigers of Tennessee State in this one. Now we have an official's stoppage of play on the field.
Timeout. Tennessee State. Their first.
Coach James Webster takes a timeout. 7:13 to go. His team trailing by 13.
This portion of the Circle City Classic has been delivered to you by Domino's, the pizza delivery experts. Get the door. It's Domino's. And by Allstate. Get a quote and help a student. Go to blackamericaweb.com for details.
It's time for the BEC Black College Tour. This week we hit Jackson State University. Y'all know we had to do it big in Mississippi. So let's check out JSU. The spotlight was on the singer.
There is no
Change don't come.
We're here at Jackson State, rain down.
And change did come. Even though it rained, the crowd spontaneity kept the flow going.
He banging his white teeth, slanging his white teeth. Go get a throw back, it's a stain on your white teeth.
Universal Motown artists, the Backwoods, and Chamillionaire were on the scene to share some love. Once again, we would like to thank our sponsors. Next stop is Clark Atlanta University.
We have really enjoyed ourselves in beautiful downtown Indianapolis this weekend for the Circle City Classic, and this entire city embraces this football game. Lots of headlines on the news and in the newspapers this weekend. Everybody looks forward to it every year. It's the 22nd annual Circle City Classic. A&T leading right now. First down. And again. And it looks like Spate back in the game. And he has not done much in his last several carries. In his four carries before that loss of yardage, he had lost one that actually that wasn't Spate, that was Ferguson once again. But Spate, the reason he may have been replaced, he lost one, no gain, no gain in his last four carries. So maybe that's why the freshman's in the game giving him a breather. Three receivers split to the near side on second down. And Ferguson lost a yard on that play. And out of the shotgun, and again, we've seen it. Rico Watkins taking a little bit of time to call the play, and his offensive lineman just can't hold that still position for too long.
Yeah, you know, his offensive line is nicer than mine. I would have, my offensive line would have talked to me. Come on, Jay. Especially Brooke Carlin and Kenny Reese. Always tell me, get me out my stands. But we talk about this game and what all it means. There's some legends that have played on this field here. And so the very first Circle City Classic, Jerry Rice got busy in it. Then you had Steve McNair. You get 50,000 plus fans every year. And look at the game. Imagine if we had been broadcasting that FAMU versus Hampton game, six overtime. We'd have been wore out. So,
yeah.
You know, you got a lot of legends that have played. One of the current Indianapolis Colts players, Robert Mathis, played in this game when he was with Alabama A&M. And unfortunately, I got to tell you this, when Steve McNair played, he got MVP of that game. He torched the Howard University Bison.
Okay.
Pre-Jay Walker.
Pre-Jay Walker. Okay, got to make sure we get that. Coach Webster not impressed with his defense committing the penalty there. Out of the shotgun, Watkins avoids the rush, but it's brought down behind the line of scrimmage. And Leonard Davis caught him from behind, so that'll be another sack. And the Tiger defense trying to get that ball back and get on the board, get right back into this one.
I guess, you know, defense is the key. I mean, you know, let's not forget, for both teams, this is a non-conference game, so the season is still young. You got to look for the positive and a negative performance that you've had out there. And if it's Tennessee State coming up for OVC Valley play, you know, you're going to need defense to get you by there. They like to score a lot of points in that conference. So they've got a defense where they can compete for that title if they find out a way to score some points.
Third and 10. And a big explosion off the far side for first down yardage and then some across midfield to the 45-yard line, 17 yards on the run.
And that's one of the problems you have when you've got a defensive line that's very active, you know, leading tackles. That means, okay, we know the front four can play. We're the linebackers. If we can account for the middle linebacker Holmes, and they got a good wham block there by the fullback for A&T, the rest of the folks in the secondary are doing arm tackling. So what happens is, you know, the linebacker core has to be in unison with the defensive front four. And right now they're not. That's a poor job of tackling by the TSU secondary.
Out of the the shotgun. Watkins looking far side, and he anticipated his receiver going deep, and he was looking for Brandon Trusty as the flag down on the play.
Great job by Aaron Strong.
Yeah.
Great job by Aaron Strong. He was beat on the double move. And your coach, if you're going to get beat on that double move, then you grab him, hold on to him, and knock him off his route. Don't let him catch that ball.
And that is Chaz Dawson. Also, you saw on the field there.
Well, take a look here. Watch the double move. He's going to come here, do the little pump fake. He's going there, and then all of a sudden, oh, no, you're not going by me, son. Just push him out of bounds. That's one where, you know, I've seen defensive coordinators come by and high-five the DB when they got beat like that. Now, how many times have you seen coaches high-fiving a penalty on your team? Hey, save the touchdown.
And the 15-yard walk-off against Strong. Now, you guys at home have been seeing, when you see a close-up, I mean, very nice-looking uniforms for A&T with the nice bright yellow numbers. But when you're 100 yards away up here in the broadcast booth, sometimes those numbers are very difficult to distinguish from way up here to way down there. So we'll get the identifications correct for you most of the time, but every now and then we'll miss one. After the penalty, first down yardage, this is Ferguson racked up in the backfield, and a host of blue and white clean him up for a loss of at least 3 yards on the play. One of the last guys in there, Jamar Landrum, coming up from that Rover spot.
Yeah, you know, active guys, there's no quit in this defense right here, but give credit to North Carolina A&T. I mean, you work on things called four-minute offense, which is basically, you know, football cliche for let's run out the clock. And they're doing a good job of running out the clock right now. The clock just keeps ticking. The running backs are staying inbound, and they're getting it 3 or 4 yards at a time. And even when they lose yardage, at least the clock continues to run.
One thing we had not mentioned earlier, and you have to wonder about it, is Quante Spate healthy? Maybe he tweaked something and got injured, and that's why we've been seeing a lot of Ferguson here in the second half. This is A&T's best drive of the second half, and we got a mishandled exchange on the snap, and I think that ball's still loose down there.
Tennessee State, I think they got it.
And they do. The signal is for Tennessee State Tigers to recover the fumble. First turnover for A&T in the game. Maybe things turning around for Coach Webster. His team still trailing by 13. A&T's first turnover of the game results in Tennessee State getting the ball in fairly decent shape at their own 34-yard line.
This reminds me a lot of that Jackson State game we had earlier in the year when Jackson State played Tennessee State. Tennessee State was bad, bad, bad. But in the fourth quarter, they found a way to turn it on.
Ball start. Number 74, offense. Penalized 5 yards. Remains first down.
State has played a couple quarterbacks today. Andre Davis started the game. Richard Hartman came on to relieve Davis here in the second half. And we'll take a look at the comparison of their numbers. Very, very similar.
Well, you definitely know they took those pictures before the game. Put those smiles on their faces there. Two interceptions apiece and no touchdown. Not too much to smile about, but you still got hope.
Hartman with pressure coming in his face. And that was by Ricky Lewis, who already had the touchdown on the fumble return earlier in the game. And Lewis was all over the quarterback that time, forcing a short throw.
He's active. Look at the Aggies. Look at the Aggies. North Carolina. You know, interesting note, they've got, currently they have the most NFL players from a historically black college. They've got 6 guys playing in the National Football League right now. Congratulations, North Carolina A&T. Make sure those guys send you a check, too.
And the handoff going up the middle to Denard Cox. Cox gets across the 30 to the 31. Extracurricular activity after the play as Tennessee State in the hurry-up mode on offense right now as we're approaching 3.5 minutes to go in this one. Third and long. On a third and about 13. Aggies showing blitz. Come out of it. Throw over the middle. And oh, right in the hand of the safety man. And he was just trying to look that one right in. Johnson back there. Wilbert Johnson, the backup strong safety. He couldn't be hitting a better place to get a pick than right there where he had.
Well, that was proof positive that a defensive back is nothing but a wide receiver that can't catch.
Timeout being signaled by Coach Webster with 3:26 to go in the game. Joe Torre has been going all over the place here at the RCA Dome to look for the best-dressed man, best-dressed football fan, and he might have found him. Joe?
Oh, yes, sir. Clifford and Claude. hands down, have worn the best dress of this event, the Circle City Classic.
Thank you, Joe.
You know what I'm saying? They pop their colophone. You know, that's how they do it. They can go from here straight to a party and then roll out the bed and go to church.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. The best dress. I don't know what the prize is, but you see who winning that. Now, the ballad bands are something different, but this is a whole nother.
Well, we're trying to bring back the era of the hat.
Era of the hats when everybody was wearing the gangster hat.
They say they bring up the hat. What's up with your hat?
So what now?
What's up with your hat? How you break your hat?
This is the way I roll every day at work.
Every day at work?
Yes, sir.
Must be a good job. Must be a good job, y'all.
All right. Sam, I roll also like this also.
Okay, okay. Okay, well, hey, take some notes. I think, Jay, you need to take some notes because, you know, your suit's kind of tight, especially out there soul food. We'll see y'all later.
Ask him, is that a brim or a fedora? I like those brims, but dressing like a gangster is illegal, ain't it?
I guess it's okay to look like one.
And Joe, anytime you want to wear a suit and get some of this, you and I can go at it.
I just think it's funny, really, man. Really classy and dapper myself. I've always liked the hats like that. But the pinstripe look gives it that gangster feel, I guess. Fourth down, they're going for it. Hartman needs 13 on the out pattern and overshot Fred Burnett. And that'll be a turnover on downs. And A&T with 3:21 to go. You would have to think they are in pretty good shape right now. They'll have it first down and 10 on the 31-yard line.
Right now, Coach Webster is saying, man, I left North Carolina. But you got to chase a dream, you know. And this is just a first-year process. And I think, you know, one of the things he's doing is bringing discipline to this program. I mean, little things that you see away from the field. You know, he came in there and said, I'm shaping young men's lives. And let's not forget, I mean, this is Black College football, but it's all about molding, you know, young men's lives. And, you know, one thing they do when they travel on Friday, he make kids go to class. You know, most guys go straight there on Friday morning and leave, but they actually make the kids go to class Friday, and they leave after class.
New quarterback in for A&T, Roderick Stevens, 6'2", 200-pound junior for Coach Small. And now we have a timeout on the field. So Stevens will have to wait a couple minutes to run his first play of the game. His team up by 13 with 3:21 to go.
Accelerate your life.
3:21 to go. North Carolina State with the ball in great field position at the 31-yard line of Tennessee State. And a new quarterback, Roderick Stevens, a 6'2", 200-pound junior, will keep it on the rollout. And Stevens, good yardage inside the 30 to the 25-yard line. So calling a gain of close to 7. He's out of Midway, Florida.
He's got some jets. You know, this isn't fair. You know, this is how coaches, the stuff that goes on behind the scenes you don't know about. He's bringing them in here and having them do rollout runs just so next week when they're opposing defense, they got to prepare for this guy now. You know, game is out of hand. You know you're going to win, but I understand you want to get him some experience. But also, you know, try to see, let's see what he can do, and let's show everybody how fast he is to give the opposing defense next week something else to think about.
Inside of 3 minutes now on second down. And he'll keep it on the rollout this side. Hit hard, spins inside the 25 to the 23. They'll make it third down and call it a long two or maybe a short three, if you will. Just trying to keep that clock rolling. The A&T offense have scored on two of their first three possessions of the game, and they have 0 points in their last 8 possessions. But the important thing, circle the important thing for us.
Or you do it this way, 16 minus 3 equals 13-point victory for North Carolina A&T.
And on the keeper, the naked bootleg, and a good move by the quarterback. Oh, he smacked down that time. The middle linebacker, Wesley Holmes, really laid a shot into Roderick Stevens, but not after an 8-yard gain. Move the chains, keep the clock rolling, as A&T trying to salt away this 13-point lead and get its second victory of the season.
That's the second time I saw Stevens take on Holmes, and the Holmes set him up there. Woo! That hurt right there. That's the old one get him high, one get him low. They got him good. Hey, that's taking some licks right there. Tough kid, stayed in the game, though. You know, I'm telling y'all, quarterbacks are tough, man.
Yeah, they got to be when they take hits like that. And he is a weapon on those rollout keeper plays and trying to give it to his fullback. Oh, my goodness. And that is Miguel Hall, the converted tight end, who got his first start. The freshman, 6'2", 225, moved from tight end to linebacker this week and showed why the coach thinks he has some potential there.
No, I mean, he just pummeled. I mean, that's a big fullback that got the ball. It's not like we're talking a small guy. I mean, you're talking, you know, 240-pound fullback running the rock there. He put some wood on to let him know, hey, you know, I'm an offensive guy, but, you know, one thing about offensive guys, they always like to hit somebody whenever they get a chance.
I believe that was Michael Christen, 6'2", 250, freshman, getting that handoff that time. We're inside a minute to go. And on second down, being dragged backwards by a host of tacklers, including Jonathan Edwards on the play for Tennessee State. Timeout called on the field. Not much gained on that one. Timeout taken by Tennessee State. Coach Small going to say, hey, hold on to the ball. No mistakes. We don't want to give them any freebies with 41 seconds to go.
Why not just give him the ball now? Here you go. I mean, I don't know. Tennessee State showing they can score anyway.
Not today they haven't in this Circle City Classic. Today's player of the game is brought to you by Jeep. Trail-rated capability only in a Jeep 4x4. And Quante Spate, 19 carries, 110 yards. Another 100-yard rusher for the Aggies of North Carolina A&T. And Spate, who hasn't seen action on the field in a little bit, giving way to Michael Ferguson, still did enough in those 19 carries to earn our player of the game honors.
Yeah, he got A&T going early, and that's when A&T scored most of their points, is early in this game, and that's when Spate was the man there. You know, this is the guy that started off as a third-string running back for this A&T team and is the only one to go over 100 yards on the season.
Again, they have yet to have a 100-yard receiving game in 05, but they don't need them when they're piling up yardage like that. And this, you know, a win like this will be a big morale booster in Aggieland, that's for certain. And taking the knee is Roderick Stevens there. No timeouts remaining for Tennessee State, so this will be fourth down. They'll let the clock just run down. Winning starting quarterback, Rico Watkins. Put him in a position not to have to make a lot of plays on his own to get the victory. And North Carolina A&T watch the final few seconds roll off the clock and get the victory. Moving to 2-3 on the year, winning the Circle City Classic 16-3 over Tennessee State. The Tigers of Tennessee State and Coach James Webster fall to 1-4. We'll be back to wrap things up in just a moment.
Today's Circle City Classic has been brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Over 2,800 nonstop daily flights to 60 destinations all across the country.
Mine's got a window.
Mine too.
Business travelers, we got you something. Southwest has new leather seats and roomier cabins for more comfortable flights.
Yeah, I love leather.
You are now free to move about the country.
I don't dream about going somewhere. I get there. Who am I? I'm someone who works at McDonald's. I'm someone just like you.
22nd annual Circle City Classic won by the Aggies of North Carolina A&T, 16-3, your final score. Coming up next week, our final game of the season here on BET, and it could not be a better one. The Tuskegee Morehouse Classic from Columbus, Georgia, and featuring that guy, John David Washington, also the third-ranked team in all of black college football in Tuskegee from Columbus, Georgia. Broadcast time here on BET is 7:30 p.m. Eastern on Saturday night. Ambassador of Black College Football joining me once again,
to wrap this one up. And it was really a situation where A&T got off to a good start early and really held on the rest of the way.
Yeah, I think we talked about in the open, the key to victory for this game was going to be whoever could score points and force turnovers. A&T did that. Tennessee State turned the ball over four times, and they managed to score some points off the turnovers, and that's what won this football game here.
Today's plays of the game delivered to you by Domino's, the pizza delivery experts. There's a turnover, of course, Lewis on the return, and then bunches of interceptions.
Yeah, a lot of these things are just unexplainable. I mean, you're throwing interceptions to the free safety down there, means you're just not reading your keys there. A&T defense did a good job of capitalizing on this. Anytime the Tennessee State quarterbacks threw the ball up for grabs, they found a way to go up there and pick it up out the air. And you see there, they start throwing these interceptions closer and closer to the end zone. If they could have held on to these balls right here and not or just thrown them away, you know, they would have got some more points rather than 3 points. But interceptions kill you night in and night out.
Coach Webster talked about it. They beat themselves likely once again today in the Circle City Classic. Final stats, things looking fairly even except in the turnover category.
Yeah, wow. Now, you know, it's tough to look at. You saw, you know, 200 yards total offense for A&T, and they still came away with the victory. Tennessee State, 232 yards, but the turnovers killed them. They ended up turning over five times on the day with four interceptions. Not good football played by Tennessee State.
And, of course, North Carolina A&T moving to 2-3 on the season, while Tennessee State falls to 1-4. And both teams still have some work to do, but one feeling a lot better than the other one tonight.
Yeah, and you got conference play coming up. This is a non-conference game. So if you're Tennessee State, go out there, continue to improve on your defensive performance and find a way to compete in the OVC. A&T recover from the Hampton loss and go out there and try and compete for that MEAC title.
So we've seen a little bit of everything in the Circle City Classic. The best dress, battle of the bands, and all of it.
In the 12th annual Capital City Classic. All the fun and pageantry of HBCU football is right here as two of the legendary black college schools score off for the 60th time. The football teams are rivals, the bands are rivals, and everyone from both sides desperately wants to win.